Hello and welcome to a Fast Charge special episode. I'm your host Dom here on Plague Island, aka the UK, joined by Lewis and Toddy, and over from the hopefully slightly less plaguey San Francisco, we've got Adam.
Yeah, I had no idea that that's what you referred to it.
I've taken COVID. To calling it that. Yeah. yeah, we are here obviously for the Galaxy S21 launch. Well, I guess technically it's just Galaxy Unpacked January 2021, but we all know what's coming, right?
Wink.
Where did you get this information?
I've broken embargo by disclosing that they might be about to launch some phones.
According to the stream,
did that earlier.
Well, according to the stream, I guess it's the new Galaxy Cube. So it looks
so
pretty.
A product called the Cube. I remember Huawei launched a product called the Cube that wasn't cube shaped, which confused me greatly.
Yes, I didn't like that at all. Very difficult to write up. So we're here for Samsung. They should be kicking off in about 5 minutes. We are going to sit here with the stream up. We're going to be chatting. We are going to do our best to keep quiet when they're talking and talk in the gaps, but apologies if we go over them a little bit. And then stick around once the presentation is done, because at that point we're going to go straight into our regular Fast Charge podcast. We're going to have all of our post-show Samsung discussion, and then we're going to try and run through everything big that's come out over the last week or two through CES, but also the non-CES things, like the OnePlus Band, which launched in India, the big leak of the Oppo Find X3 design, which I absolutely detest. And if you've seen it, I want to know what you think, because it's going to be very controversial one way or another. And all of that. So we're going to have loads to cover today.
It's probably our biggest fast charge ever.
Yeah, I mean, Samsung are warning their presentation could run for over an hour already, and then we're going to keep going after that. So we might be here a while, guys. Toddy, what are we expecting them to launch other than phones?
Other than phones, not a whole lot, to be honest. Oh, my cat is biting the background.
I can hear cats.
Don't mind them.
Classic. Cats really love spoilers.
But we are expecting a pair of headphones in, I think they're called the Galaxy Buds Pro, and also a GPS tracker in the Galaxy SmartTag, I think is the name they're going for.
Yeah, just beating Apple to market. We obviously like spent a lot of the last half of last year with all those surprise Apple events, and every single one it was like, is this going to be AirTags? Is that finally coming out? And it got leaked every time, and it still hasn't materialized, but Apple are working on a Bluetooth tracker too. Samsung are about to do one before them. The funny thing is, it's not their first, is it? We didn't realize, but they have a SmartThings tracker already.
Yeah, but it's like a weird, like, I think it's like a subscription service-based item, and it's like £99, and I'd never even heard of it. Like, they kind of just quietly have one just to be in the space, I guess.
You could get like 20 tiles for that.
Yeah, exactly. So if they're introducing a new one, that's cool. And it'd be interesting to see if it's cheaper as well. That's the main thing I'm kind of curious to see.
Yeah. And then on the Buds Pro front, I think what we're kind of expecting, again, these have been leaked a lot, something that looks a bit like the Buds and the Buds Plus rather than the bean-shaped Buds Live, but should have the noise cancellation of the Buds Live. So it will be a bit of a like best of both worlds. If you kind of like liked the Buds Plus design but wanted the ANC and the Buds Live, we're expecting the Buds Pro to basically smush those together and double the price.
Pretty much.
Yeah, and then phones-wise, three of them, I think, is the expectation again. S21, S21 Plus, S21 Ultra.
Yeah, just nice timely updates over last year's devices, really. Nothing else. Like, they're not going like toe-to-toe with Apple and having four phones this year. That's not what we've heard. Although, obviously, like last year, they did introduce the S20 FE, but that was later. So they might
add
in
October. So,
you know, I think we actually already have like a rumor roundup of any existing rumors for the S21 FE, if that's a thing, but we're not expecting that today. None of the rumors have suggested. The only interesting thing really about the launch itself is that it's now, it's in January, and usually these phones come out in March every year, or have done for the past few years. That in and of itself is interesting, and it's going to be interesting how that affects Samsung's marketing throughout the year and beyond.
Yeah, because I mean, this is not just an implication of, oh, it's coming out during CES. This changes financials for
a
very large company. There's got to be a reason that they did it. Does anyone have any?
A lot of the speculation before was that it was purely a way of not letting Apple have the top phone in the world for too long, sort of eat a month into that new iPhone window where the iPhone 12s feel like the shiniest thing around, and then by launching a month early, they buy a month at that time. I don't know if that really holds up for such a huge change. I also think it's particularly odd given obviously COVID and everything affecting stuff. If anything, we'd expect delays to products, not for stuff to launch early. Right. So it's kind of interesting that they're able to still pull this stuff out a month early.
Well, maybe it has something to do with just how much lead time they give these projects, especially with the Galaxy S phones and the flagship stuff.
Yep. I'm seeing something's happening. Yeah, big wall of text.
Yep.
I prefer the cube. Bring back the cube.
Yes, please. And where's that fun music?
At least we get some cats in the background.
Yeah, the occasional jangle of it. What's the jangling noise? Do they have bells on them?
They do have bells. Apologies. They're not very conducive to podcasting.
Hey. No. Cats make everything better, including podcasts. So I got no problem.
So they have to give you a little while to read all of this chunk of text.
I know. I'm surprised they're actually holding on. Oh, there we go. Okay, it's gone for me. The cube is back.
You.
Oh, it was a full stop all along.
Whoa.
I was going to say 2009. Hang on.
Yeah, they're just going through every cube logo they've had. I think they overestimate the affection people have for Unpacked as an event versus the products they announce at Unpacked.
That's a good way to put it.
So this is basically what we saw in the invitation and the kind of trailer for this event, was this kind of like blurred... Oh wow, we even have musical credits. The blurred element, which I think is the camera. Yep, there we go.
Yeah.
That we've seen in all of the leaks and renders. As if there was any doubt. Which is kind of the biggest, I think, design change over the S20 series, kind of domino camera arrangement.
We'll talk about that later once we get a proper look at it.
I know you've got some opinions about that one, Dom, so...
Lots of colours in a box.
I think it's going to be the first fully cubic Galaxy S phone. Now I can hear a dog in the background.
Yeah, that's mine.
There we go.
We had to make it through lockdown somehow, guys.
Hello, and welcome to Unpack. It's so good to be with you again. I could not be more excited about all the incredible innovations we are announcing today. They continue Samsung's legacy as the pioneer of meaningful experiences that are designed for everyone. Our universe is an entire ecosystem of intelligent connected devices that defy expectations and give you the freedom to live life without borders, without boundaries. When it comes to true innovation, we are the only game in town. Last year was a reminder of how important technology has become to all of us. Samsung Galaxy devices helped connect millions of friends and families and enabled entire industries to go remote. During this next normal, we've been working hard to support our customers and employees with our innovations. The challenges of 2020 have made us more determined to fully tap the immense power and potential of tech. This year, Samsung is pushing innovation even stronger. We will give you groundbreaking ways to personalize your devices so they reflect you. Because we want you to be free to go further, to forge your own path, without limitations, without constraints, as part of our long-standing commitment to open collaboration. We will expand the Samsung universe even more with new partners. With Samsung Mobile, where you start your journey never determines where you will go. After all, every day should be truly epic. To kick things off, I want to introduce you to a product that I absolutely love, one that I use all the time, in fact. They may be small, but they sure are mighty. This powerful design statement offers a multi-dimensional audio experience that will blow you away. Meet the next generation of our incredible earbuds, Galaxy Buds Pro.
All right, everyone's ready. Yeah, that was fast. I like that. I was worried we were going to have 20 minutes of talking about COVID and how much tech has saved us.
Yeah. Well, good thing there's a disclaimer. It says the image is simulated. yeah, I thought this was real for a second. So.
Yeah, that's the Samsung Giant.
Gone space fully key. Liquid, fully yeah. T. What is it? T1000.
Yes.
I do like the color.
Yeah, yeah. This is the Phantom Purple. I'm assuming they're using the same names that we've seen from the leaked phone colors for right. The headphones. But yeah, like I like it a lot.
Purple.
Sorry, they've Phantom done a Violet, lot of purple. Sorry.
Okay. They've done a lot of purple products over the last year or two, and I'm really here for it. I've liked almost every purple color finish they've done.
Do you prefer this to the Mystic Bronze that the Note series was showing off at the end of last year?
For sure. For me, personally.
Hmm.
But I still think the best they've done was the Z Flip, that pinky purple, mirror purple.
Flip can
maybe
do no
I can't
wrong
remember.
For you, man.
No, perfect phone. I like these as well, though. They're slightly rounded compared to the Buds Plus. A bit more curved.
Because you reviewed all of the Galaxy Buds,
not the originals, but the Plus right. And the Live. Yeah.
Right.
So these do look design-wise that they've taken a few cues from the Live. They're a little bit more curved, a little less angular. But still proper in-ear headphones with tips, which obviously the Live aren't.
Here are Galaxy Buds Pro, the most immersive sound experience on Galaxy Buds. We use earbuds to listen to our favorite music, watch our favorite movies, and connect with the people we love. They help us tune into the content we care about and tune out the content we don't. They even transport us to another world, just us and the audio we love. With earbuds, we can watch movies that center us and listen to music that helps us connect with ourselves. Earbuds give us personal space when we need it most. If you listen to music often, you know what a big difference sound quality makes. The foundation of our Galaxy Buds lineup is amazing sound, and Galaxy Buds Pro are packed with pro sound quality. Galaxy Buds Pro come with the most intelligent active noise cancellation on true wireless earbuds, so you can transition seamlessly between your universe and the world around you. The Galaxy Buds Pro will make your listening experience extraordinary. Our engineers and designers worked closely together to bring this incredible sound experience to life. Let's listen.
The goal of Galaxy Buds Pro is simple: to deliver the best sound experience, period. Most earbuds immerse you in audio and stop right there, but Buds Pro are different. They redefine the sound experience to transport you to your inner and outer worlds. This is how the Galaxy Buds Pro are designed and engineered to enable a sound experience unlike any other. Nothing immerses us in our inner worlds better than captivating sound. When building Galaxy Buds Pro, engineers were inspired by the highest quality audio devices around. Speakers. Most premium speakers use a two-way system. Okay. A woofer delivers bass, and a tweeter delivers high pitches. They work together to create rich, premium sound. But most wireless earbuds only use a one-way speaker system. The reason? Size. Building two-way speakers into a small earbud body requires an innovative solution. So engineers tried a new approach, system in package. SIP minimizes the size of each chip and organizes them into dense stacks to integrate all parts into a single component for more optimal use of space. This breakthrough in engineering enables the Galaxy Buds Pro to feature two-way speakers. The Galaxy Buds Pro set the standard for sound quality on wireless earbuds with Stunning Sound by AKG. But sound quality doesn't end there. the Buds Pro delivered 360 audio for realistic immersion. Using intelligent motion tracking sensors and Dolby head tracking, Buds Pro can detect head movements. Now, when you turn your head, the audio will recalibrate and put you in the middle of the scene. What really takes audio to the next level is active noise canceling. The Galaxy Buds Pro uses its outer mic to monitor ambient noise and its inner mic to monitor noise inside your ear. Based on these noise readings, the advanced chipset generates an anti-noise signal and eliminates up to 99% of background noise in real time, letting you enjoy only the sounds you want to hear. But as much as we love being immersed in our own worlds, we need to be able to connect with the world around us. Enter Intelligent Active Noise Control. With Intelligent ANC, as soon as you start to speak, a microphone detects for your voice while a sensor detects for vibrations. An advanced AI algorithm then ensures your voice isn't mistaken for other voices to confirm you're in a conversation.
Hey, how you doing?
When I reviewed the WH-1000XM4, I believe is what it's called, which had this, it didn't work well for me.
This is also something that Pixel Buds 2 supposedly offer, this kind of dynamic ANC.
I didn't notice it, if that's the case.
So far, no one's particularly impressed with this tech. Maybe Samsung's got it right. We'll have to wait and see, I guess. I think the plan is for us, Dom, you're going to be reviewing the Buds once they're available, Buds Pro.
Maybe.
Verdict's still out. Someone will be reviewing it soon.
Once the voice pickup unit detects your voice.
Yeah, the problem I had is that when my wife was too close to me, it started triggering it by her voice.
Okay.
So it didn't just link to my voice and only do that. Also, there were at least on the XM4s, there was two different variations of how long it would stay muted, or the music would stop. And in each case, it was way too long. I think it was like 15 and 30 seconds.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so it's just like, okay, even when it triggered when I talked, then I had to wait 15 seconds at least for the music to start again, when I'd be like, yeah, I'm done talking.
No leftover breeze makes its way into a call. With Galaxy Buds Pro, it's no longer necessary to choose between being immersed in your own world and being able to connect with the world around you. Enjoy the ultimate sound experience with Galaxy Buds Pro, tiny yet powerful earbuds.
Audio has the power to move us. Music transports us to different worlds. We get lost in stories through audiobooks and podcasts. And time flies when we're chatting with our friends. Galaxy Buds Pro understand and adjust based on what we're doing. They can recognize when we're listening to tunes or catching up with family, and figure out when we want to move from our phone to our tablet and back again. An auto switch lets Galaxy Buds Pro switch with you. If you're watching something on your tablet and your phone rings, don't rush around. Galaxy Buds Pro will easily switch audio to the device you're using.
That only works if they're both Galaxy devices.
No need to fiddle with settings or wait for a connection.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess I can say, because it's past 3 o'clock GMT now, that I was at the pre-brief for these, and they only made mention of like Galaxy devices and the way it seemed to work. It's tied to a Samsung account, I think.
Right.
It works the same way as it does with the AirPods, essentially, I think.
Yeah, basically, yeah, exactly.
Make Galaxy Buds Pro fit more securely. They're designed to sit just right within three key parts of your ear. We also added a 2mm vent to the outer shell of the buds to create airflow and balance the pressure around your ear. So you'll have a balanced fit without the feeling of tightness.
I will say the Buds Plus and the Buds Live were both super comfortable, super secure fits. I think Samsung is very good at that in their bud design, I think.
Galaxy Buds Pro stays securely in my ears. I can trust that whenever I take my mask off or remove my hat and scarf, my buds will stay right where they are. And at IPX7, the Galaxy Buds Pro have the highest standard of water resistance in the Galaxy Buds lineup. We intricately shaped every part of Buds Pro to make your everyday listening experiences exceptional, right down to the case you put them in. If you have a pair of Buds Live, we've made sure you can still use your accessories. You can get own pair of Galaxy Buds Pro in three amazing colors. They'll be available for $199 starting January 15th. Let's take another look.
It's not bad either, is it, really?
Yeah, I think it's what's the pricing for Europe? I have it in my notes somewhere. That sounds right, yeah. €219. I think it's €229 as well.
Okay, yeah.
Something like that.
Pretty competitive for what they are.
I mean, they're at least, 40-50 quid cheaper than the AirPods Pro, at the very least. Mm. So that's always good. Now, what you hear is up to you. Why you playing
with me? Here you got me. I'm just saying, like, with incredible sound quality, intelligent ANC, and our most secure fit ever, Galaxy Buds Pro will transform your listening experience.
Do you think the AKG brand holds weight for people looking at buds and audio products nowadays, especially from Samsung?
I suspect the Samsung brand holds more weight.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah. I find it odd that they still lean on AKG.
I mean, as an audio professional, AKG definitely holds it for me. Mm. But yeah, I think any normal person
looking at products like this.
Yeah.
So we've expanded one of our favorite services to help keep track of the things that matter most to you.
I mean, I think
Smart
the only...
Things find. We've made our web service even easier to use.
Razer putting THX certification in the headphones. I think that carries some weight, THX. Oh, I know THX.
Smart Things Find has given you peace of mind when it comes to locating your phone. Last October, we extended it to help you track and locate your wireless earbuds, tablets, and smartwatches. And this year, we're expanding Smart Things Find even further so you can track any of your belongings, even if they don't have a built-in connection, with Galaxy SmartTag. Galaxy SmartTag allows you to take charge of your everyday belongings in an extraordinary way. It's a small, portable device you'll be able to easily attach to the things you
based
love
based on
most,
other trackers I've seen, it actually looks kind of big.
I was just thinking that too.
So you can trust that SmartTag will help you track down
Well,
that makes all the difference.
Even if they've been gone for a while.
I'll see myself out.
Imagine that you left your door open and your dog ran off.
Much better than AirTags.
You're still panicked,
you know.
Not knowing where your pet is gone. With Galaxy SmartTag on his collar, you'll be able to track him using Smart Things Find. If he's far away, the smart tag on your dog's collar can send Bluetooth signals to a community of nearby Galaxy users.
So it's not GPS based, it's Bluetooth LE.
The Galaxy Find network that powers Smart Things Find is encrypted from end to end.
I think ultra wideband as well.
Ultra wideband's involved.
While keeping all data from Galaxy users in the network untraceable. Once Smart Things Find locates your smart tag, it will notify you about its whereabouts.
I'm loving
and
this
you'll
little
experience
dog in a jumper,
the relief
though.
That comes from reuniting with your dog. You can attach a smart tag to your wallet, your suitcase, or even your bicycle. And if you have trouble finding your smart tag, you'll be able to ring it and follow the sound. Remote tracking.
I mean, you'll be able to find the smart tag, but you won't be able to find the valuable attached to it.
Yeah. But wouldn't it be great if you could find the precise location of your lost item? With Galaxy Smart Tag Plus, you can.
Oh.
Galaxy Smart Tag Plus is built with ultra wideband technology, or UWB, an advanced wireless communication system that makes your devices smarter by giving them spatial accuracy and directional capabilities. And the same system can help you locate things.
So this
by
is not.
Combining
I don't think any of the leaks that I've seen
AR.
Around this have made mention
Thanks
of two
UWB
different
display
models.
Galaxy Smart Tag Plus.
This one's closer to what Apple's planning, apparently, with the ultra wide band.
Unprecedented accuracy by guiding you to their location. They'll take you to the bookcase in the corner of your office that your keys fell behind.
Damn it,
losing pets and personal
keys on
items
books.
Is a common problem. But with the Galaxy Smart Tag Plus, you'll be able to find your favorite things wherever you left them. And we've made sure you'll love your smart tag as much as you love the things you put it on.
See that little bubble
we've
case?
We've made cases to fit all your needs and to show off your
I don't
want to
drop
style.
It.
You can get a smart
tag
on
there
January
too, obviously.
29th.
Of course.
And you'll be able to get
a smart tag
plus later this year. Galaxy Buds Pro and
Are they going
Galaxy
right off the
tile
with these multi-pack tags as well?
Everyday moments into experiences
I think it was only a $10 premium for the plus version, which is... Not
there
that bad, actually. $30 versus $14.
Yeah, I like the colorways, too.
I just want to know if it's replaceable
Thank
batteries
you,
or not.
The Galaxy Buds Pro and SmartTag are such great additions to the Samsung ecosystem. But we're not done yet. We live in a mobile-first world, and you deserve the ultimate mobile experience.
All right, phones.
This year, we
you
want
do,
you
Adam.
To give you yeah.
something.
You
do deserve the best.
Sweet. Thank you.
Treat yourself.
Empower you to express yourself and live your life exactly how you want. I am so proud to introduce our new flagship device, the Galaxy S21.
Designed still need for 5G in the name.
I know, I was just about to say that. Like, come on. Point, oh God, I can't wait for that point where everybody just Galaxy drops 5G.
It's groundbreaking.
As a name.
Point should be now, I think it's okay.
Yeah. Once you had it in last year's one, drop it.
Yeah. Although we were kind of going backwards, like... Poco doing the Poco X3 NFC as well.
Yeah.
Just check the spec sheet. That's fine.
And user experience. And an FE camera far beyond anything we've made before. So good that it makes everyone look like a pro. Especially its video capabilities where you have the power of cinema in the palm of your hands. I'm incredibly excited to introduce a smartphone that changes everything to make your everyday epic.
I mean, it's a bold claim when I'm sat at home every day at the moment.
Whoa, this WhatsApp is so epic.
Show me what you got.
Is now a good time to talk about the camera, Dom?
Purple good. Gold camera bad.
Yeah, what is that? I'm not a fan.
I actually quite nice like blue. The shape of the module.
Nah. Yeah. I've chatted with like product design people at like Canon and that in the past, and they've been adamant that they need to have a gold or gold accented product in their lineup, just like they need to have a black one.
Right. Yeah.
Because in especially in Eastern markets, in markets like the UAE, gold sells. So yeah. They need to have some sort of gold option in there.
I get
doesn't it.
It
signify so like high end, like really
sure Galaxy wealth, yeah. opulence, mm-hmm. you know?
These days, we Bling. Rely on our phones even more than we used to. They help us discover new music, chat with our friends, and just enjoy the everyday. With Galaxy S21 and S21 Plus, you'll have a device that changes everything and helps you get the most out of every moment. A smartphone that makes the everyday epic.
I was kind of hoping all the promo images would have people wearing masks.
And this year, we are ready for something
at least some.
New.
Yeah,
we
exactly.
created a revolutionary new photo and video experience with incredible enhancements in our camera technology. That much innovation requires a fresh new design to match. And that's why the S21 series looks like nothing you've ever seen before. We've created a contrast cut design by combining
you know what? I
the
actually
camera
really
shell
like the look of
the
it.
Frame of the photo.
It's growing on me.
Yeah.
First leak, I didn't like it, but every time I see it this since, it's really grown on me.
Yeah, I don't mind it at all.
I mean, I wish there wasn't
color
a bump.
You get.
Mm. Mm. I wish there, like, I hate camera bumps in any form, but
I think what I prefer, which is something we kind of saw with the Huawei P40 series last year, is that kind of like shimmery kind of satin matte reflective back.
Galaxy S21 comes in four colors, while S21 Plus
now,
comes in three.
We
give you different
so
options to fit your unique
yeah, that
style.
Purple's really nice.
These devices are designed to open up a world of extraordinary new experiences, starting with their stunning world-class displays. After all, the display is one of the most important parts of any smartphone. We use it to chat with our friends.
Now, one thing they didn't touch on when
flat.
I was briefed, and no I don't think they're going to mention here in any great depth, is that the base S21 is plastic backed, like they did the Note 20 last year. Yeah. So, was the S20 plastic, Dom?
No. That one's still glass.
Yeah, yeah. So, the S21. Plus and Ultra, they're glass, but the base model is a rather what they call it, like reinforced polycarbonate or something. They didn't use glass stick at least, but something to bear in mind. It keeps the weight down, but it's a different material, different feel on the hand, different wear as well in terms of how it will wear over time. So that's something to bear in mind if you're considering any of these phones.
We've made another leap forward, building the S21 series with an adaptive screen that goes between 48 and 120 hertz. Whether you're scrolling through your social feed or photo gallery,
I mean, I guess that's double of 24, which is cinematic.
The
but
contrast ratio
still,
and unbelievable peak brightness let you enjoy all the vivid colors in the content
Wait,
you're watching.
Get to the ultra.
Even if you're outside,
does that mean
on
it will
really
keep the high resolution?
Day,
and the high refresh rate.
This display doesn't just
well, the other thing is that both the 21, 21 Plus are full HD this year, really extended. They are not WQHD like the S20 range, so they can do 120 because they don't have to go past full HD. They can't go past full HD. The Ultra is different, though.
Okay.
I don't want to jump ahead.
Galaxy S21 and its 6.2-inch display, or the S21 Plus and its 6.7-inch display.
It's also slightly bigger than last year, I think. I think it was 6.1 for the 20 last year. I might be wrong, though.
With vivid colors
Similar,
and adaptive refresh rate
yeah.
and eye comfort shield.
Yeah, there was also someone like did like pixel measurements on leaked imagery, and apparently the bezels are much more even this time around, which is, you know, harder to achieve. Usually the way they have these curved displays work is that they fold all the kind of display connectors into the lower half of the display, so the bezel on the bottom edge is usually the thickest one. And they look to have kind of eliminated that with this generation, which is quite nice because not many phones have been able to do that so far. I think the Pixel 5 has done it, and I'm not sure about the 4a 5g. I haven't seen that firsthand, but I'm pretty sure they managed to do that there as well. But they have much thicker bezels, so this is probably one of the nicest, if you like, a symmetrical front.
And relive the moments that matter with pro-like photo and video quality. Thanks to AI, this pro-grade camera does all the thinking for you. It knows how to adjust its settings to give you the brightest, most natural photos with three lenses that render your memories crisp and clear. That kind of intelligence turns everyday photography into an
Super
epic experience.
Dual pixel autofocus.
And it's all possible with the computing power of Galaxy S21's brand
it's
new
still
processor.
It's still a fake telephoto, right?
Yes,
64
exactly,
megapixel telephoto isn't really a telephoto.
I didn't have figures to like math out like we did last year until we get the phones. You can't math out just how much of an actual telephoto lens it is, but yeah, it's mostly digital.
And the higher the quality of these images, the more it feels like they're in the room with me. With the combination of our new chipset and photo-enhancing AI capabilities, S21 and S21 Plus capture every detail and provide you with more natural and vivid portraits than ever before. The portrait experience on S21 series is simply amazing. These new devices will automatically separate the subjects from their backgrounds to bring depth and focus to your photos. And the intelligent camera on S21 and S21 Plus enhances the natural bokeh effect, whether in broad daylight or in the dark, so you can capture beautiful portraits under the stars. The S21 series has various portrait modes that accentuate the subject and make them pop. Our new devices even detect the direction of light to help you capture studio-quality portraits. With studio mode, AI adjusts the lighting to create perfect portraits that look crisp and natural. High-key or low-key mono modes round out your photo, and you can even have AI select matching colors to automatically create a stunning backdrop. We know you love the portraits you take of friends and family, including your pets. They deserve the best quality portraits too. The S21 series captures amazing portraits of your four-legged friends
wearing?
Using AI
one.
Detail. Portraits are
like
a great way to
Scooby-Doo.
Take gorgeous photos of the people and pets we love. But sometimes I want to snap a shot of another important person, me. Selfies are how I show the world my best looks and how I bring my friends into my favorite moments. With AI-based face enhancement, you can enjoy high-quality selfies anytime, anywhere. Using a super smart image signal processor and advanced multi-frame processing, the camera makes your selfies look their absolute best. And when you're
taking
a selfie,
the lighting
is so important.
I think most of the front camera improvements are basically software. I don't know whether they're using the same exact sensor, but it looked to be just a 10 meg unit again on the 21 and 21 Plus.
Your natural skin tone will be reflected in any lighting condition, even extremely warm or colorful lighting, without sacrificing the realness of your photo. Social media helps us connect with others and express ourselves. And sometimes when we want to share a picture, it's just easier to use a camera that's built into our favorite apps. We've been working closely with our partners to make the awesome visual experience from our Galaxy devices available on their apps. Now, the AI solution on S21 and S21 Plus gives you an incredible visual experience in most third-party camera apps like Instagram and Snapchat.
It's a small but quite important change.
Yeah, it really is. Take and post the best it's hard to describe possible. To people like, hey, you're going to get a better photo if you take it first in the native app. And then feed it to Instagram.
More and more often, we're using videos to communicate and capture real-time reactions, moments that make us cry and make us laugh until we cry. With the S21 series, you can capture every detail in cinematic quality
without any extra effort,
thanks to 8K video. 8K is a revolution in video resolution. 8K video revolution. Is four times sharper than 4K, giving you super high quality in every shot. These videos are so sharp, you no longer have to choose between taking a photo or a video anymore.
I'm curious with here, because the Exynos chipset can do 8K at 60 frames per second, which is super impressive, and the Snapdragon can't.
Yes, the phones are limited to 24 FPS in 8K.
Really?
Yeah.
That's what it was last year.
I wonder how sharp it's actually going to be. Like, they're saying how sharp it is. Obviously, if you have like a fairly static scene, it's probably going to look nice and crispy, but yeah.
That's really weird. They built a new chipset that can improve on that, and they even the Snapdragon does 30 FPS. They could have bumped up to that
by enabling you to shoot photos on chipset basis at least. All at once. Just hold the camera for 15 seconds. I mean, based on the SmartTag news,
maybe there's still more that they haven't told us already. So maybe they'll either drop that in an update, or they're just saving it for a future device because it's like a bigger number they can just drop on the Note 21 or whatever they call, you know, the second half of the year big release.
Single take will give you a bunch of options to share right away. But sometimes you want to do more than point and shoot. You want to choose a right angle, focus on your subject.
So, I've never used it once.
Yeah.
So, we thought about new ways we could give you control over your camera. And we created a new visual experience called Director's View. Now you can see preview thumbnails from all your camera lenses while you shoot. That way, you can easily change angles,
This is cool, yeah. You can make sure I can't remember who did it. It might have been Xiaomi. They have something similar where you can kind of preview all the cameras before. From portraits to selfies to single
take and director's view are powered by the fastest chipset.
I don't know if Mi 11 does it. I think to some extent that's something that the 888 allows and the also the Exynos 2100. Because they can do three lenses simultaneously.
This chip represents the most significant leap in our chip performance ever. And that starts with the CPU. We're delivering 20% faster CPU, 35% faster GPU, and two times faster AI.
It depends which version you get. All of this chipset, that stuff they're talking about now is for the Exynos model, but if you're in the US, none of this is relevant to you.
Giving you the power to reach 20 tera operations.
I'm just going
to
go take a nap then.
The S21 series can process graphics and AI faster than any other Galaxy device. So whether you're taking portraits, recording videos, or starting the next viral trend on TikTok, you'll have the power to capture extraordinary memories. We rely on our phones more than ever to get things done. So the security of our most sensitive information is more important than ever. At the heart of our enhanced security system is a secure processor, which is engineered to ensure that your data stays protected even against advanced hardware attacks. For the S21 series, we work closely with both Qualcomm Technologies and Samsung System LSI Business to develop a secure processor that meets our stringent security requirements. In addition, we brought a whole new layer of protection customized for this processor by adding a physical, tamper-resistant, secure memory. We call it Samsung Knox Vault. With a secure processor, secure memory, and integrated software, this vault will safely store your device PIN and password, biometrics and blockchain, and Samsung service authentication keys. We also upgraded the S21 series privacy features for the pictures and text files you share. Now you'll be able to remove location metadata from photos to keep your location private. And if you have photos, videos, or text files that you want to share with friends, but you don't really want them to keep, we've got a solution for you. With Private Share, you can share your content and revoke access whenever you please, or just let it naturally expire after 2 days so you can send your content worry-free. With our Knox security and super intelligent processor, the Galaxy S21 series is our most private and powerful yet. And S21 Plus will last all day, even in a 5G network. 2 years ago, we launched the world's first commercial 5G smartphone. And our leadership continues with hyperfast 5G, engineered to give you the best network experience possible. 5G will unlock faster and more connected experiences, giving more of what you love with less lag. That high-level connectivity makes the S21 series the perfect phone for everyday mobile gaming. As you know, we've been collaborating with Microsoft to bring you Xbox games on mobile via the cloud. 5G makes it possible to take your favorite games with you while keeping them fast, smooth, and stunning right on your phone. And that's not the only gaming experience our S21 devices lets you enjoy. We continue to partner with Unity to build the ultimate mobile gaming experience. With Unity, we developed adaptive performance, giving you the games you love without the battery drain or overheating you find on other devices. With this package and our new powerful processor, the graphics get better, the phone stays cooler, and gameplay gets faster than on previous Galaxy devices. Adaptive performance has been applied to over 100 titles so far, and this list will only grow in the years to come. With ultra-high performance on our best-ever processor, an everyday game will take you on an extraordinary adventure. The S21 series offers the most powerful
publishers or developers I've never heard of before you got to Square Enix and Riot. I assume they're big names in Asia.
They are truly exceptional
Nexon. I know Nexon.
Oh, really? Okay.
We know you need technology that makes your ordinary moments extraordinary, and that you want to enjoy delightful experiences. That's why we've built One UI 3. Hey, are you ready? Count 1, 2, 3. Strap! One UI 3 takes the digital experience to the next level. It's ready to delight users with a refined design and empower them with enhanced customization. Our latest UI mixes style and function. With its fluid design, you'll feel the difference right at your fingertips. Comfort and efficiency were our top priorities. Take a look. The new design has so many enhanced visual effects. It allows you to focus on the task at hand and put your eyes at ease. The lock screen now comes with new widgets. You can see more without even unlocking the phone.
That's what everybody wants.
I think it looks better, but I can't really tell. I don't know whether I prefer it or not. I guess use it and find out.
Made the edges even more circular.
More squircles.
Turn frequently used functions on and off quickly.
And then when UI4, they'll like square it all out again and call that progress too.
Yeah. All
transferring data from your old device can be a chore. Simply connect, select, and the rest of your new device setup is easy. One UI 3 totally transforms the mobile experience across the Galaxy devices. One UI 3 makes you smile with dynamic images that change every time you unlock it. And it keeps bringing you joy with a camera to capture the moments that matter with One UI 3's AI-based support. One UI 3 will manage your favorites easily through the new gallery. It even handles low-resolution photos, like the old ones on your social media feed. One UI 3
takes the impending loss of free unlimited Google Photo storage. I'm now seriously considering like which native gallery apps I might want to rely on if I'm going to start storing images locally.
Need some downtime?
Just you and your game? We got
you. A lot more.
Your device blocks calls and messages and manages resources for optimal gaming conditions. Get totally into your game and take it next level. One UI 3 provides seamless continuity between phone, tablet, and computer. Sync Samsung reminders with Microsoft and manage them on apps like To-Do, Outlook, and Teams. Start a project from your phone and finish up on a tablet or PC. One UI 3 will analyze usage patterns to help you better manage your digital habits, and your phone can stay in optimal condition.
Samsung's done a better job of integrating Microsoft and Android than Microsoft ever has.
Totally.
And customizable. I mean, they sell them in the Microsoft stores, right? Like, yeah. They're the first phones you see if you go upstairs.
Designed by you. As you can see, One UI 3 is easy to use, customizable, and aesthetically pleasing. It's full of smart features that will make your experiences more epic.
It looks like a very modest change.
Just think about your phone.
Yeah, it's an Android 11-based One UI experience, like stuff like the music widgets that you can jump between, all that kind of stuff.
Too often, our shots are almost
and the squircles, obviously.
Yeah.
And with Object Eraser on One UI 3,
that's fine, though. I think One UI has been good recently. I like One UI, generally.
I'm still not sold on some of the icon redesigns, but the general usability I'm totally okay with.
AI does the rest for me. Easy, right? From your photos to your gallery to the interface itself, One UI 3 brings joy to your everyday, and you will be one of the first people to enjoy the full experience with the S21 series. S21 will be available starting at $799, and S21 Plus starting at $999. Both models can be yours on January 29th. S21 and S21
okay, so
Plus
a
are
wait.
Breakthroughs.
I thought it might be a bit longer than that, given the early announcement.
An intelligent refresh yeah. rate, 4 cutting-edge camera lenses, and performance.
I'm guessing pre-order is
going to
start from today.
To keep you more
or tomorrow, maybe.
To
I don't know.
Or tomorrow, yeah. yeah.
Whether you choose S21
this seems
or
so
S21
early
Plus,
in the year to get
yeah.
Samsung phone. It's so
that
weird.
Will change the way you navigate our world.
I still can't believe Xiaomi dropped their new phone on the 28th of December.
Yeah, when the whole Western world was asleep. Yeah.
yeah. Obviously, Chinese New Year is until I think it's Feb, so it doesn't yeah. matter yeah. as much for the market. But still, just like thought it was fun.
I guess they wanted to get out before that.
Yeah. To be the first with an 888, I guess.
Yeah. That was all it came down to, really.
Yeah.
We actually just got the second 888 phone this week. Was the Vivo IQ 7.
Oh yeah, which is again China exclusive right now, right?
Yeah. And then I guess these are the third, fourth, and fifth for the markets that get Snapdragon.
The first international, I guess.
Yeah, that's true. Actually, it's the first outside of China. But then in Europe, we still don't have an 888 phone.
Yeah,
Wilbert 7 in the comments on YouTube says pre-orders are live.
Oh, ooh.
So
it's going to get
I know, like
go
China
get one
and
right
the
now.
US. Yeah, China and the US had like a kind of register your interest page already in place and have done for a few weeks.
Mm-hmm.
But obviously didn't mention pricing or anything like that. So now I presume you can see all the SKUs and the different storage options and RAM options.
I really
yeah,
do not like
now.
That camera.
It's right there.
You don't like the camera on the Ultra?
No. There's too many,
it's not
too
pretty.
Many cameras.
It's pretty functional, I think. It's pretty utilitarian. Everyday moments
into extraordinary experiences.
It's so clean on the normal S21. You know, 1, 2, 3, but this one gets a little...
Yeah, it's a lot happening.
Very messy.
More freedom, more power. That's the same problem they had last year.
Our Ultra
line has become they want to throw in so many cameras, there's no way to make that look nice.
Yeah.
Something about the Phantom Silver option in the press imagery, it reminds me of like 80s Japanese tech, and I kind of like that. But it's a very specific aesthetic that I don't think everyone's going to appreciate.
So you never miss a single moment. As a new dad, I'm always taking photos of my 20-month-old son. I want to capture every memory. From his first steps to his first words. So I thought about investing in a DSLR. But with this phone, I don't need to. Galaxy S21
Ultra. I
think
it must be so weird to be one of these people's kids and like become an app, you know, grow up and then find out your photos of you as a toddler were like watched by 300,000 people in a press event.
Give you an enhanced visual experience and open up a world of possibilities.
They made him sign
the
a release.
Precise
just held his hand and scribbled.
108 megapixel wide lens broadens
worry,
the scope
son,
of what
we'll
you can capture.
College.
The 12 megapixel ultra wide lens adds more detail to every picture you take. And with our enhanced AI, the brand new dual telelens system creates a breakthrough in zoom quality. Our hardware and software teams work together
so they can't
to build
one
a camera
telephoto
experience
than the other ones, but they can put two in this.
Yeah. I'm down for that though. I like the approach so within the context of this phone, obviously.
Yeah.
Like, I would have appreciated one over just a high-res sensor, I think, in the others, but yeah, I like the approach of having two different dedicated tele-lenses.
It works well.
Yeah, especially if you're going to go 10 times
exactly.
on
the
molded optic one. Yeah, because it's...
Yeah.
And they've gone for the laser system that they implemented with the Note, which fixed the dodgy focusing of the S20 Ultra, so that's just kind of carried through. And the sensor's supposedly faster here as well. The main 108 meg sensor is a cool. better low light sensor and a faster sensor, despite having the same, I think it's the same aperture and the same pixel size, but it's just an improved component.
And it all starts with our most advanced image sensor.
They should have just thrown on one more and go ultra wide, you know, get like a fisheye. The first time I get a phone with a fisheye, that would be awesome.
I mean, there's like, you know, phones that say they have like an action camera lens, like Motorola especially has done this, so like, they could have put one on here. I think it's without the question that they probably considered something like that.
In situations with ample lighting, Remosaic technology maximizes resolution
to
produce
just
stunning photos by rearranging and optimizing all of the camera's 108 million pixels according to RGB Bayer patterns. The Galaxy S21 Ultra.
See another phone with sensor-based image stabilization, like the 12 Pro Max, the iPhone 12 Pro Max. I was kind of in the back of my mind. I wonder whether Samsung would kind of jump on the same train here. When I was writing stuff, though, I was curious whether there's been a phone with as many sensors with OIS built in, like standard OIS, because this one has it on their main sensor and both tele sensors. They all have OIS systems.
Oh.
Which I don't think of another phone that has three OIS systems built into it. So it's a weird flex, but it's cool.
And the folded optic one actually probably has two.
For the mirror and the
exactly. Prism, so maybe technically there's four in this phone.
We'll stand by for the Jerry Rick everything teardown video to find out, I guess. When even
the
human eye struggles
to see. The S21 Ultra sensor uses AI for a powerful night mode experience. With one press of the shutter, multiple frames are processed at incredible speeds to eliminate noise and blur. Then, countless reams of data collected by the sensor are processed by
an AI person inside the camera. Like, okay, how does this one turn? Oh, throw this one out. Oh, how does this one look? Oh, throw this one out.
This is possible even in conditions of extreme darkness.
Sony sensor tech that I think is rumored for the. We might be getting onto this later, actually, with the Oppo. But can simultaneously do these high contrast, low contrast compositing in real time. So it's not taking multiple shots one after the other at different exposures and combining them. It's combining them all in real time and capturing them all in real time, which I think is a cool if the tech can support it. I presume these chips would be powerful enough to do that.
Extraordinary hardware sets the foundation to capture professional quality images in any situation. But hardware is only half the story. Powerful software maximizes the strengths and benefits of our incredible hardware.
I like this zoom photography. I don't think it's an anechoic chamber, but
is it the holodeck from the Enterprise?
There we go. Yeah.
And you come across amazing view.
Really there?
But you can actually get to the
other
side. I was
trying to figure out whether on that stage, because some of the backlighting and the way the kind of perspective change on the cube lighting looked real. But I'm not sure how.
I don't think so.
No, I feel like they wouldn't have made a whole stage, but they've done their due diligence in making it look convincing.
Yeah, it depends. Yeah, it's changing from presenter to presenter. The last lady was real rough. Around the key edge.
Like a cardboard cutout sort of effect.
On the Galaxy S21 Ultra is a turning point in the zoom experience, offering superb clarity.
How would you describe space zoom on the S20 Ultra?
To improve image quality with 1 to 10 times zoom range.
I think I remember it being impressive, just pointless. Up to at least 100 times.
At the 100,
that kind of silly, we can do 100. It was just kind of fine, but the results are grainy and horrible, and it does kind of work, but why? But, I think the sensor was 10 times like this, or maybe 5 times and then 10 times hybrid. At that level, it was very good.
Into the lens to minimize
thickness. I actually, for the first time, had a reason to use the folded optic zoom. Here by where I live, there's the Oakland docks, and they have those big cranes that unload the shipping containers, and they just unloaded 3 new cranes off of a boat onto the docks, and so we kind of parked somewhere, and I was trying to get long shots, and I was like, you know what, I'm gonna whip out the Note 20. And sure enough, I was okay, 5 times zoom for this is perfect. Any other time I use it, it's just kind of for novelty, wonder how far I can zoom in. But this was a situation where I was you know what, this is perfect.
It's just how creepy do you want to be? Beyond 5 times, it's kind of just creepy or just show off weird flex, but okay.
But they have kept 100 times in because they didn't do 100 times for the Note series, right?
Yes, they went 50 times at the Note,
But they just showed there is 100 times on this, which is purely a decision about branding and marketing or whatever. The Note could have done that if they wanted it to.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. And they're also showing it's, the algorithm that, kind of the HDR, the way it builds HDR shots, it's sampling multiple shots and then compositing them and using the kind of data of multiple shots to iron out the noise and the shake to try and get a better quality image, because they are pretty naff at 100 times. Another thing they haven't really touched on yet, which they might still do, but they seem to have moved on to the next camera, is they've introduced this thing called Zoom Lock, which
they just showed that briefly.
Right, yeah. So above 30 times zoom, I think, and up, it helps with the stabilization. So you can tell it, I want it to try and focus on the thing in the center of frame, and it will try and kind of really lock down the stabilization. I don't know whether that's like an overdrive for the OIS system or if it's an electronic-only system. They didn't detail that when I was told about it, but it seems like a smart addition when you're kind of, especially if you're trying to do a handheld shot.
Has the most power we've ever built into a smartphone camera, giving you the freedom to shoot and edit your favorite moments to make them even more memorable. You'll be able to capture incredible.
I was throwing out compliments to Sebastian Sung the other day because of his like fashion game in the Samsung CES event. I'm not sure about the roll neck here. I don't know if it's if it's the right look for the phone. I'm thinking maybe a sharper suit to kind of reflect the phone's kind of like, you know, business and productivity credentials. Performance.
Yeah, I don't know if the S20 Ultra user wears a roll neck.
Let's take a look.
I can't take credit for the way my mama raised me. What a woman. She taught me how to be a Wonder Woman.
I think that siren was from Udon, but it does work with the kind of industrial look of this dance video, so.
I just filmed a dance video the other day and it looked like crap. Yeah. So much better.
It's because you're shooting on the S20, man. Like,
I know, yeah.
This is the tool for the job right here.
Wasn't that great? At Samsung, we believe filmmaking should be possible for everyone. So we're building our Galaxy smartphones to establish a whole new kind of cinema. Mobile filmmaking.
Oh, that's the lady who dances on a longboard. I follow her on Instagram. She's pretty fun.
Is she US-based?
No,
We're excited to continue to grow the Galaxy community around the world.
Yeah, whether she like she'll just like longboard down the street and just dance
the
and move.
Cash.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Will be incredible, and you'll be able to store it effortlessly thanks to Microsoft OneDrive integration. If you start filming a masterpiece on your phone, you can upload it to OneDrive and edit your work from your PC. Galaxy S21 Ultra is a bold device that delivers the best of the best, and we designed it to look just as bold and iconic. From its sleek frame to its stunning matte finish. It's a masterstroke in design.
I do quite like the matte.
And we created a striking color to match. Introducing Phantom Black.
Black or silver?
I think I lean black, though I know you were earlier saying you like the silver.
Just for that very specific aesthetic I was on about.
It's bold, yet understated. Black is classic.
Bold, yet understated.
Luxury. So they started by telling us what we use headphones for, and now they're telling us what black is.
For designers, black is the most difficult color to create.
It's pretty ballsy doing a whole video devoted to why you chose to make a black phone, like you've made every year for the past decade.
I feel like Apple really ran away with it when they introduced they had the matte black and the shiny black. If you bought the highest
order black,
was that the 7 series?
Wasn't it? Well, not the piano shiny piano. What was the iPhone 10?
Right.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and that was super scratchy.
Yeah, it just got scratched up immediately, didn't it? And everyone went, oh, that was a bad idea.
Yeah.
In our quest, we conducted countless tests. We examined molding, the process to create color patterns, vapor deposition, the process to create the reflective layer. We even examined glass etching. Nothing was quite right.
Nothing's right. Black is just eluding me.
Just tearing like a wall worth of like diagrams and illustrations down in frustration.
Is more. We need to start again.
Removing the traditional processes was an extreme, uncompromising gesture. But we needed to break new ground. We put all our focus
What is going on here?
He's like, no, black get rid of this black. Get rid of this black. This isn't it.
First, we built
I feel like
the
this
film
is a pretty specialist job at companies like Samsung. So, like, almost all light. You could say, oh, I'm not sure if I like it or whatever, but surely this guy's, like, opinion is what matters. So he can kind of say whatever the heck he wants and be like, this is what we're going with, this is the right black, this is the right finish.
I mean, he's got to be the expert in black, so it's just like, okay, I can't argue with you, you're the expert.
We discovered an optimal haze glass that preserves a deep, resonant black. One that shows the color in its truest form.
Resinous black. I like that.
I mean, isn't black the absence of color? Efforts
is the Galaxy S21.
Or is it?
This guy doesn't even know what colors are.
And modern. We fashion this singular black not by adding more, but by using less.
Think about it.
Whoa.
This is astonishing.
If they're going to spend this long showing us a video about black, we have to talk about black, otherwise it's nothing.
Galaxy S21's.
How is this still going on?
Phantom black is our boldest color yet.
I like when Apple introduces colors to the easy show, you like smelting like the gold.
S21 is an epic experience in and of itself.
Oh, they're not going to do that for every color.
That best-in-class experience continues with S21.
You know, earlier I mentioned, like, all phones, there's usually a black variant. Interestingly, the base S21 doesn't actually have a black option. It's phantom gray, and it is a slightly lighter, different hue to the 21 Plus and the Ultra. I'm not sure why they chose to not just do a flat black or a solid black.
Because then you realize it's the exact same as on the Ultra model.
Yeah.
That's the groundwork of our AMOLED display. And we've applied this newly discovered material to S21 Ultra. With this innovation, we've managed to reduce power consumption in this device, even as we provide an improved viewing experience in high resolution. As you switch between videos or pause to check emails, your phone will automatically shift between 10 and 120 hertz to optimize your viewing experience.
That's, yeah, I'm not sure again why it's different. I guess, you know, this is the biggest panel and it's the highest res panel of the series. So if you can go to 10 hertz, the power efficiency is better. That's my assumption.
Yeah.
I don't know why the others couldn't also go to 10 hertz, except for just to help differentiate the three phones.
Yeah,
that's literally it. Yeah.
1,500 nits with a dynamic AMOLED 2X
brightness by about 200 nits. But this is not, I think, the brightest screen they've ever done. I think the Note last year, for example, was like rated at going past 1600.
And 100% color volume for more accurate, realistic color. S21 Ultra's display is our most advanced ever, and we made sure every part of your experience will match it. That's why we're introducing Wacom technology to S21 Ultra and making it the first ever S-series device compatible with the S-Pen.
There we go.
For all the Galaxy Note users out there, you know that the S Pen is more than just a pen. It puts precision at your fingertips, so you can take charge of your
mobile. How odd it is that they had an S Series and an S Pen, and it took until now for those to put those two.
Wait a minute. There's something we can do here.
Now bigger with a more comfortable grip, and the more advanced S Pen Pro. The S Pen Pro lets you take advantage of all the great Bluetooth features you've come to love.
So this is how they get rid of the Note line.
Like using air actions,
Yeah. Photo remotely, I was wondering whether they were going to sell the same pen that they bundle with the S Pen Pro. Tab S7 series. All these amazing features. But it looks like they've made two separate, again, completely new pens.
Which is bad. I mean, we moaned about Apple when they had two Apple Pencils, but how many S Pens are there out there right now?
Yeah, and I assume they're going to show the case. I'm guessing the cases only work with the smaller of the two, so the other one you still have to store it like you would any pen or pencil in like a bag or something.
S21 Ultra is the only model in the S21 series compatible with the S Pen. Because S21 Ultra is any,
clicky at the end. It's like it's my the greatest fidget item.
True. The original fidget spinner.
Yeah.
On January 29th for $11.99, and you'll be able to make it truly your own and choose among three gorgeous backplate colors that match the unique camera deco pattern. If you choose the S21 Plus,
is that gorgeous though? I'm not sure about the carbon fiber.
Some of these colors are horrid.
I like that red one.
I don't know,
with
the gold though. Like, if you could change the camera module as well to match, fine. Or black. If they used the black one as the base, that would have made more sense. But
it's the red and gold together that doesn't work for me.
Yeah.
The red itself is fine.
Yeah, I'm not sure about the carbon fiber.
I also hate the carbon fiber. I think that's what you're talking about, Toddy, when you said you thought, you know, I was going to have opinions on the module. It's the, carbon fiber I really...
Well, I noticed for the thumbnail for this episode of Fast Charge, it features the leaked carbon fiber.
It was the highest resolution leaked image I could find.
Nice.
I presented it. And then we have a background that's more carbon fiber on the background of the thumb. And I was like, no, we're doubling down on this.
S21 Ultra. I mean, I say that, I've got a phone case right now, which has like a Kevlar, but carbon fiber kind of aesthetic. From the phantom black finish and brightest.
I'm not against carbon fiber, I just don't think it works just in the camera module, you know.
As a concept and a material, not against it. They didn't really mention the Wi-Fi 6E as well, by the way, which is a small thing, but I think it's cool. It's better future-proofing. It just adds in basically a kind of just outside of 6 gigahertz like frequency ranges for Wi-Fi, so just faster and better Wi-Fi in the long term as more routers and stuff start to support that.
No matter which model you choose, it's a revolution in smartphone technology, and it's a revelation in how we live our lives. With Galaxy devices, you can make every day easier and every experience more epic. To learn more, please welcome Federico.
Thank you, Charlie. As head of experience planning at Samsung, my role is to understand
how... I was going to say, what more is there to learn?
This.
...to design experiences that address our needs and delight...
We've even had pricing for both everything.
Samsung, yeah.
We work hard to develop products that make your everyday extraordinary. We work with partners to deliver better experiences so people can enjoy the very best of mobile technology.
Of a side shot of the case that had the pen, pen on the side of it. I'm trying to look for other photos of it, but
Tech Advisor at least. And I assume that your friends over at PC also have shots too.
Okay.
So there are a few press images floating around now with this.
With OneDrive across your devices or play Xbox games on your phone. And we continue to work with Google.
It's just all going to be about their partnerships. They're talking about expanding the Samsung cinematic universe. So I guess this is that.
Make exploring your interest easier than ever.
With the Note launch last year, they showed off for the first time the kind of partnership with Game Pass. And they had the Moga controller as well.
Yeah.
And then nothing really came of that. They didn't really kind of highlight it on their website or anything. They just kind of, it just existed.
Well, that was from Microsoft. That was like just after the Game Pass thing launched on mobile.
Yeah,
I think it was just Microsoft wanted to push it. The timing was right for Microsoft, but
with integrated video calling, you can easily
it never even became very clear what benefit you got from being on a Samsung device versus any other.
Video calling, you want to really at Samsung. We are uniquely equipped to deliver this experience.
It can't get pulled off the Google Play Store. They'll just put it on the Samsung store.
Yes, that's the one benefit. You've got the guaranteed Samsung store access.
You
will be able to connect your video calls to your TV, so you will have a big screen entry point to every hangout. These are just few of the incredible experiences that we have made possible. With every innovation, people
as
inspire.
As an accessory line, I don't know if that's a new charging dock or something. One thing they don't mention is charging, actually, on any of these phones. They never mention charging speeds or charging tech. So we can touch on that in a second.
Many of our
if they don't drop it at the very end. Oh, here we go. Yeah.
And to leave the new I wonder what that looks like.
Unused. Yeah.
This planet is a home
so
we all share.
And
we,
compact.
Samsung, are doing our part to leave it better for future generations. With your preferences and the planet in mind, we are proposing a way to prevent these
they
unused
save
items
just by not
from
including
piling
a,
up in your drawers.
An adapter.
Your S21 device will come with a USB-C cable that's compatible with many of your other devices. And our chargers will remain available
so
for anyone who wants one
as well, which is
lower price.
Yeah.
It's what Apple
problematic well. Again. Yeah,
it's a bit unhelpful.
Make your life easier. That's why we build
at least
the
you can connect one into
ecosystem.
The phone directly. In this case,
connect it to another OTG phone. Just get a charge up there.
Take your morning routine. Waking up is hard for many of us, but now you can customize your devices to kickstart your day when you shut off the alarm. You can set your lights, blinds, and TV to turn on, so every morning your home will wake up with
I
you.
I do not want my TV to turn on first thing in the morning.
No, God no.
BBC News and all know.
Well-orchestrated devices that make your day smoother. We know that today, well-being and fitness are more important than ever. So we are determined to help you to understand and manage your health. You can use a Galaxy Watch to monitor your heart rate, to measure your blood pressure and ECG. And we reimagine your TV so you can follow a workout while you're watching yourself in action. By projecting your phone's camera to your
still
TV,
confused by this
you can perfect
segment,
your
other
phone
other than the bit where they talk
sure
about the boxes.
No, right
nothing
pros.
Else in this is new.
It's reminding you that they also sell other things, I guess.
Like, it's a whole ecosystem, guys, remember?
Yeah.
Every single day. To tell you more, please
life
welcome
better
to
if you buy everything, Samsung.
Yeah.
Thanks, Federico. Here at Samsung, we offer one of the largest product ecosystems
had,
in the world.
A special edition, like they did
the
Tom Brown
of, the
of the foldables and stuff in the past.
And award-winning home
I wonder
appliances.
Whether they were going to do one.
And we're proud that our connected S21
series,
network
but
of technologies
doesn't appear to
be. Makes even your most ordinary experiences exceptional. At CES, you heard about how the SmartThings ecosystem makes life at home seamless. SmartThings lets you do so much more than just turn things on and off. you can truly take charge of your home. To help you revolutionize all of your everyday experiences, we're looking beyond our own ecosystem. We're finding new ways to make the ordinary extraordinary and expanding our galaxy beyond just Samsung products. We partner with Google to give you a smart home ecosystem unlike any other by making Google Nest products compatible with SmartThings. We built SmartThings to be a powerful service that lets you customize your world to make every day more convenient and efficient. Now you can change your temperature on your Nest thermostat or check your Nest Cam and Hello Doorbell, all from the SmartThings app on your Galaxy phone. A seamless home experience is just a few taps away and housed in one easy app. But the reality is, we don't spend all day at home. This year,
yeah, we do.
We hope we'll be able to get out.
What are you talking about?
We'll need connections that let us manage our homes, even when we're on the go.
I wonder whether SmartThings has better product integration than Apple HomeKit. Apps,
you'll be able because to the layout looks difficult. Very similar, to say the least.
It's kind of what I put in my head. I was like, hmm.
Heater before you even get in the driver's seat. We spend
they
a lot of time in our
they
cars.
They make a lot of appliances. So if you buy a Samsung washing machine or a fridge, so then, you know, obviously they're expensive products generally. They're not the thing that most people buy, but
bring the power of your smartphone to your car.
There isn't yet an Apple washing machine.
Yet.
Android Auto
well, not,
has been
not
adopted
the one you
by
can
every
buy.
Major car manager.
Yeah.
The iWash.
Not great marketing. On the road. So in most cars, you can connect your Galaxy device.
Back in the day, they would have called it the iWash.
For sure. For sure.
And we made your experience smoother, faster, and easier than ever. So you can enjoy your Galaxy experience right at your fingertips. Samsung and Google have worked closely together to improve the user experience in the car display. The smartphone-like visual experience
what,
will feel more intuitive.
Washers
and
Pro
familiar.
Max.
Yeah, with access to your favorite navigation
and, if you have two of them,
and entertainment
do...
apps.
Do you pluralize you washers? Or
washers Pro Max.
While keeping your hands on the wheel. You'll be able to operate your SmartThings ecosystem. SmartThings makes it easy to manage your home wherever you are. Thanks to deep integration with Android Auto and SmartThings, you can control
this
your home from the
boring.
Dashboard of your car.
Yeah. Like,
it
I use CarPlay.
Kind of edited it that way too.
Yeah.
Imagine you're
like they're holding on his smile just a little too
there's always
long
a little
on some
pause.
Of those cuts.
Yeah.
It's hard to relax. I'm just like a lot of this they could have included in their CES keynote because there's definitely more overlap there. Like
totally.
They already showed phones in that presentation.
Product.
They didn't highlight what the phones were. And they could have done the same with this. So yeah, it's odd that they are just basically retreading the same ground. I guess it's for the people who didn't. My Google
Nest. I think they're really just banking on they've got 220,000 people on their stream right now, but that's a lot more than they have on the CES stream, I'm betting. So
fair.
They just knew they have a captive audience for this.
It's super convenient.
Also, that clip shows you that they shot separate footage with different dogs to show off that vacuum. They'd already shot a different dog and cat clip as well.
It'll direct me to the nearest charging stations. And thanks to the combination of my Galaxy device's GPS and
looking at the US site, just jumping back to the phones whilst they're talking about vacuums, I think. The Phantom colors that are exclusive to Samsung.com, so they're not even carry exclusives right now with the The S21 Ultra, you have Phantom Brown, Phantom Navy, and Phantom Titanium. I think these all include that the option of that carbon fiber camera. Yeah. And with the S21 Plus, you can get Phantom Gold and the Phantom Red that Lewis loves so dearly.
And a relaxing night for you. Android Auto and the SmartThings ecosystem free you from the ordinary, giving you more downtime and more extraordinary experiences. You can enjoy your Galaxy everywhere. In your phone, your home, and your car. We're thrilled to think about where this technology will take us next. We continue to lead the way with services that make your daily activities seamless. With Digital Key, you'll be able to open the door of your house with your mobile device. This Digital Key gives you a trailblazing, touchless experience. You'll be able to unlock your car door with your phone. The door will unlock when you reach it. No sooner, no later.
Oh, I kind of like
you'll
the
even
SP
be able
cover
to
with
Digital
S Pen.
Key across smartphones, regardless
yeah, you like the aesthetic
of
it?
Platform. So if I'm I
just think it's probably one of the easiest ways to have an S Pen in the case, but also have the extra functionality, because that the straight up S Pen or the silicone cover with S Pen, it just makes it wider. Gives a little channel.
Yeah. So where does the pen store on that one?
On the cover, they're not showing it specifically, but it looks like it might come up the spine. It doesn't look like there's a channel on the side.
Right. Yeah.
Making them more readily available, secure, and shareable.
I'd almost be okay to have it on the back, like the S7 series tablets, because then you could turn it into sort of like a slight prop for landscape view stuff when it's on a flat surface, which I'd appreciate. And also, I imagine it's already going to feel really freaking wide just as is before you add on a big case with a pen in it.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
We're partnering with the world's largest car companies to take your auto experience to the next level.
Either way, it's hard because in the note, you literally have a place to put it.
Yeah.
In the near future.
Yeah.
But that's not the only partnership we want to tell you about today. To tell you more, back to you.
That's good. The S Pen isn't included, is it? The S Pen is sold separately with this. It's not like the note where it's totally part of the product.
For years, our partnership with Google.
There's somebody else talking even more.
Has led to some of the greatest innovations in mobile technology. Together, we have created
the fastest charger, which I haven't seen before, and a new Duo charger. They're both on pre-order.
Those were leaked a bit, but I'm surprised they didn't talk about them at all during the show.
They didn't talk about charging, period. Like, it's very odd. 25-watt travel adapter, some hefty cases.
It will yield new innovations across the board. Really. Whether you're behind the wheel or in your home office, look forward to exciting new mobile experiences. For more about our new partnership, please welcome my good friend, Hiroshi Lackheimer.
Just gonna keep on going, huh?
Just gonna keep powering through. They're doing AMD in reverse. AMD spent so long doing interviews of execs yesterday.
And what we've been able to build together since the first Galaxy S21.
Yeah. Pop off whenever.
It does mean, if you're not in our position, you just tune out. They have dropped, they were about 300,000 people watching the main announcement. It's down to 200,000 now, so a good third of the people watching are fed up with this.
World-class technology to create an amazing, cohesive product experience. Not only are we bringing our innovations closer together on the phone, we also recognize it's a multi-device world, so we are building beyond the phone together. As TM mentioned earlier, staying connected with friends and family is a top priority for many of us. Google Duo and Messages.
Do we think this means that if they're not going to do a later in the year note release, that the foldables will become that later in the year?
That is, the assumption. They've got every quarter, there's potentially a new foldable or scrollable, something in the wing. So I think the next up is expected to be the next Z Flip devices. Could be one, could be two, an affordable one and a pricier one. At some point, there's expected to be a Z Fold 2 successor, either an affordable one or a fancy one or both. And then they might bring the scroll out this year, which is that kind of expandable one, kind of like the Oppo X2021 concept that we've seen. And the LG Rollable, that could be this year. Yes, yeah. So maybe.
Available first on Galaxy.
Yeah, this still really helps
shape the future of how everyone interacts with their phones. We are in a multi-device world.
From the leaks, there's been people very back and forth on whether we're getting another Note this year or not. There seems to be a lot of disagreement whether everyone agrees the Note line is ending. People can't agree whether we've already had the last Note or whether there's one to come this year and that will be the last one.
I mean, the Ultra was a solid last Note if that is the last one. The regular Note 20 was an abomination, really, for various reasons. But
for those of you interested in using the S21 for work, you'll be pleased to learn that it's an Android Enterprise recommended device. The S21 exceeds the program's elevated hardware and software requirements for business use.
Oh, good.
The Galaxy S21 is an incredible device that brings the best of the Samsung and Google collaboration. I'm inspired by what we'll be able to build together by bringing the magic of the Google ecosystem and Samsung's amazing technology together to innovate and to create helpful experiences for you, our customers. In 2021 and beyond, we are taking our partnership to the next level, and I am incredibly excited for this new era. Kudos to the Samsung team, and thanks again for inviting us. Back to you, TM.
It's gotta be the last one.
Thank you, Hiroshi. Today, we've shown you what Samsung is all about.
Oh yeah, he's recapping.
True innovation that opens up a world of untapped imagination.
And now for part two of the presentation.
Experiences that defy all expectations, so that you have the freedom and the tools to be yourself and to express yourself. Of course, the power to imagine new products goes hand in hand with the power to imagine a better world. We have always been committed to using technology as an instrument for good, to doing the right thing for a betterment of the world.
That commitment as well
led us to partner with the UNDP and help promote
Tell it to Razer.
Razer, just a few they always try to ago, push the boundary. And it's just
they just had some budget left, let's be honest. Like, what can we do?
This program, I'm still sore they never brought up Project Linda.
I wanted Project Valkyrie. That was my one.
Which one was Valkyrie?
The three screen laptop that folded out, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That got stolen.
Yeah, that one.
Somebody's got it.
Generation 17 is about elevating the voice of a generation, unlocking their power of purpose, and taking action together. Young people are coming of age during a global pandemic, and their optimism, determination, and resilience is more important than it's ever been. We are honored and humbled to help them reach their goal. We all have the power to affect change. It only takes imagination and a sense of purpose. I hope you will join us on this mission. On behalf of everyone at Samsung, thank you again for watching Unpacked today. Stay safe out there, and we look forward to seeing you again soon.
Everyone look under their chairs. There's an S20.
Okay, great. So that is Unpacked done, I think. So stay here right now if you are watching live. So I think from this moment onwards, it is now Fast Charge episode 48, officially. We're here. If you're just joining on the audio version, I'm Dom here today. As always, I'm joined by Toddy and Lewis and Adam from the American PC World team.
Hello.
So we've just been watching the Samsung Galaxy S21 launch. So let's start with that. And then after that, we're going to turn to basically all things CES, the Oppo Find X3 links, leaks, and kind of everything else that's sprawled out in the tech world over a very busy week. What's our sort of overall feeling on that Galaxy Unpacked? Why don't we start with you, Toddy, because you were pre-briefed on this. You've had a few days to get your head around everything.
Yeah, I've been kind of wading through mainly specs and details. Nothing too kind of out of the ordinary, nothing too surprising. It is a kind of just regular refresh of the three devices that we saw last year, S21, S21 Plus, S21 Ultra. They also introduced the Galaxy Buds Pro, which are kind of new in-ear, again, like a return to in-ear, true wireless buds with some of the smarts and the tech that they implemented in the Galaxy Buds Live. And then they also introduced the new SmartTag, which is basically an enhanced, not GPS tracker, it's a Bluetooth LE / ultra wideband tracker, depending on which model you go for, which we can talk about in more detail. But yeah, three phones, one tracker, well, two trackers, and one pair of headphones. And yeah, most of it had leaked. We kind of knew. The phones especially, we know 90% of the picture, I'd say. There wasn't really a lot of surprises in there in terms of the phones.
I think I mean, Samsung's just been like hit so hard by leaks over the past while. I mean, it's awful. We had full high-res product renders, and that's been the case for a while for them. Someone pointed out on Twitter, I saw earlier, someone saying that, I think it's saying on leaks, kind of has in 6 months single-handedly ruined Samsung's two biggest product launches and the iPhone 12 reveal by like just getting absolutely everything out there. Even on the day, you suddenly get a torrent of new stuff that turns up just hours before the launch event.
And we had a GIF gaff drop in the pre-order stuff and the phone. Yeah, they're pre-order
one
pages
of the UK carriers
ready to go.
I like the look of the phones. I find it interesting that obviously they've redesigned them a lot. The aesthetic is very different. They talked up a lot how that's because the cameras are radically different and this is a huge leap forward for Galaxy. And obviously they say that kind of stuff every time. Nothing felt like a huge leap forward to me. These feel like attractive, nice phones that I like the look of, but I couldn't point to any single thing that felt game-changing to me.
No, I feel like the contour cut camera arrangement is almost like, especially on the base S21 and the S21 Plus, is almost hiding the fact that the camera sensors underneath are what looks to be identical, or if not, only very slightly tweaked. They're the same resolution, at least, same f-stop, same pixel size. So there's nothing that suggests they are new sensors.
Yep.
And it's the same kind of weird telephoto setup by the looks of it, where it's just a high-res sensor, which we talked about a lot last year because we were a little bit miffed by Samsung. I mean, they can claim it's a telephoto sensor, but it's still about the resolution.
Yeah, for context here, the last year and its carried through to this year, the base S20 and 20 Plus, and now this year the 21 and 21 Plus, have what is advertised as a 64 megapixel telephoto camera, whereas the Ultra models have these like three times and ten times. Last time they had it, I can't remember exactly what it was. Those base ones, they are like, once you do the math, they're at like 1.1 times zoom.
Yeah.
So they're kind of like, you know, in terms of opticals, they are technically more of a zoom lens than the main lens, but fundamentally they're just a high-res sensor that they digitally crop into. The funny thing is, it's fine. The results are fine. I was perfectly happy with what you got out of the S20s.
Yeah,
we haven't
for sure.
tested a 21, so we don't know, but I assume it will be at least as good. It just is a bit funny when everyone else is putting actual 2x, 3x, 5x zoom lenses in equivalent phones, and Samsung obviously has that for the Ultra. It's weird that they're trying to call this a telephoto when it's at least stretching the truth.
As we said during the stream, I think I would have preferred them to go for a periscopic telephoto, just the one on the at least the S21 Plus.
Yep.
But they have not. They have just stuck with what they kind of introduced last year. I have higher hopes for the S21 Ultra's camera setup. It seems like they've thought about the set of sensors that they put in there a bit more, and they also look to have addressed the weaknesses that the S20 Ultra's camera kind of brought to the table with that 108 meg sensor.
Yeah, I mean, last year's was a big disappointment, right? I think it was for such an expensive phone, and for the first Ultra they did, we were expecting a lot, and then we got it into test, and generally I thought the base S20 camera was better than the Ultra's. I think they patched a lot of things. I suspect if you buy one now, the Ultra is probably better, because I know they've done their best to fix a lot of the early problems. But still, it was definitely a disappointment. They wanted to have the best camera in the world, and by no measure did they. But I know the Note 20 Ultra, everyone thought the camera there was a big step up, and it looks like this is kind of taking the best of both, you know, and the learnings from that 20 Ultra.
Well, they had less time to do it, because this announcement came really early, so...
Yeah. Nothing in there about why they changed their timing. I was wondering if they'd address it in any way and acknowledge that they were launching these a month early, and they didn't touch that at all. Still no clearer. You were talking before, Adam, asking what we thought was the reason. I know I mentioned there was that theory that it was to eat into Apple's time. I actually think probably the best bet is it just gets them out a month ahead of everyone else. Because we know, we'll talk about it in a bit, but you know, the Xiaomi Mi 11's been announced, that's out in China. It's going to be coming to Europe at least probably this month or next month. We're expecting the Oppo in March. The OnePlus has also actually moved up to March this year. Everyone's expecting. Sony will probably announce a new flagship in February, March. I mean, we just normally get a glut of flagship announcements in February, March. Samsung is normally part of that glut. Now it's a month early. It gets a month of being the only flagship in the West, right? Or the 2021 flagship.
And I guess it further distances themselves from MWC, where that's where they used to do the announcements, and they kind of broke off from that, and now it's even further.
Bad news for MWC. If they, you know, try to go back to being a normal trade show next year, and it's in theory still happening this year, but in the summer, not its normal February slot. But if they try and go back to February now, they're like, Samsung's not going back, are they?
Anywhere close, yeah.
No. one thing... Oh, sorry, you go ahead.
I was just going to ask one last thing. I was like, wait, why isn't DJ Ko hopping on stage? And I don't know how much of this is because he's not there as the head of their smartphone division. So I don't know if that plays into it. It seems like probably way too quick of a decision to make, unless they knew for a while that he was on the way out. But I wonder if this is a signal change, at least one of the first signal changes of him not being the head anymore.
Mm.
I mean, they've got to transition to other people and have other people ready to be the face of this kind of stuff, I guess. One thing picking out from the comments, got Darren pointed out something that Samsung themselves glossed over. There's no SD slot anymore, which they have always done. And now it is just the internal storage and that OneDrive partnership.
Yeah, I heard no mention of on any of them expandable. It was only an Ultra feature on the Notes as well last year.
Oh, was it?
Okay. Yeah, so that they killed it on the base one. Another reason to kind of dislike the base Note 20. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it looks like the whole range. Your storage is, I think, 128 or 256 for the 21 and 21 Plus. And then there's also a 512 model on top of that Ultra. For the Ultra, which is nice. I think that's a decent amount of storage. I don't think people are going to complain about that.
No.
It's just having the option of expandable storage is what's nice.
Totally. I personally have never really stressed about it. I don't use expandable storage, but then I know I change phones so much quicker than most people do.
Yeah.
So I can see if you're buying the one phone and you want to use it for 2 to 3 years and you know you take a lot of photos and videos or something like that or download a lot of media to watch, I can see that it's still going to be a sore point that you might buy that 128 and be stuck with that.
Which
definitely doesn't feel like enough.
I think we're all in the same boat on that, but for me, it's more like it really hurts when companies take options away.
Yes.
Back in the day, hey, you could change out your battery if you wanted. Did I ever do it that often? No, but it's nice that it was there. That they took away a headphone jack, taken away micro SD card. It's like when they take something away that used to be there, it never feels good.
And on that note, we mentioned it earlier, but on the base S20, it's moved to a plastic back from glass. So that's a downgrade from last year. Mm-hmm. And the resolution has dropped from last year. So
charger in the box as well.
A lot of people to look and no charger and headphones. So I think a lot of people could look at this and say, well, the price is around the same, but it feels in a way like you're getting a lot less with the base models, one way to fix the problem that last year the base models were so much better than the Ultra. They've just kneecapped the base models to make the Ultra look better.
Yeah, you can see why these phones are cheaper. Like, I don't think they've made any sacrifices that are damaging to the offerings overall. Like the fundamentals are still there. You still get the top tier chip and you get, I'm sure, decent cameras. The only thing I think is like Ultra Wideband, they're kind of going pretty hard on that tech with this release, with the SmartTag Plus and the fact that not all of them offer that, I think it's a minor thing. The average user isn't going to care that it's not there. But just in terms of getting that technology out there and getting it in play, it's a bit of a bummer that it's not on the base S21, but it is on the Plus and the Ultra. So,
pricing-wise, so are they cheaper? I don't have last year's prices in my head.
A little bit, yeah. Let me get my my master document of... which is it's live on the site now. I compared all the prices and everything. But yeah, it's not hugely cheaper. I think it's like £50 cheaper starting price. But that is the starting price for in the UK. We had a 4G version of the base S20, which was I think £799. And now they made no mention, even though they have 5G in all the marketing, then it made no mention of 4G SKUs anywhere. So we are assuming that they all come with 5G as standard.
There might be a 4G in other markets, maybe, because there are still a lot of countries where 5G is even more in its infancy than it is in the US or the UK. I can forgive them keeping 5G in the name if they do still have a 4G model somewhere out there.
But for us, it was £799 for the 4G S20 last year, and it's £769 for the 5G capable S21. So, and that 5G S20 was £899. So in that regard, it's over £100 cheaper.
Okay.
From 5G
that
to
is 5G. Pretty decent, actually. That's a bigger drop than I was expecting. I knew we were expecting prices to drop a little. That makes me feel better about those little downgrades they've made. It positions it more in the way Apple's begun positioning the iPhone 12 and the ones like, that kind of the base iPhone. Bigger gap where they're a bit less at flagship-y for the base model. And
it's 99 cents more for the the S21 in the US than it is the iPhone 12.
Okay.
So it's pretty much right on there.
I'm going to stick with an iPhone. I just fair.
So I do wonder if it's come from that direction. They eyed up that iPhone price point and just looked and said, right, what have we got to take out to hit that? And they said, resolution's got to go, glass back's got to go, but they just wanted to hit that. It's the same price as an iPhone.
And maybe the launch window changing, like, it's unsure. Unless Samsung actually told us, we wouldn't know for sure whether that had played into it, but it makes sense, being on the market longer.
Yep. We didn't really talk about charging. So obviously they kind of buried the lead a bit and only revealed right at the end, after probably a lot of people had stopped watching the stream, that as rumored, there is no charger and no headphones in the box, following Apple and following Xiaomi, who've also copied Apple since then. I don't think it's too unfair to say, yes, they are just copying Apple. Apple did this and we all knew Apple was doing it and Samsung have done it. I think it's fine. I think it's a good thing to do, but it also gives them the chance to really not talk about charging, which is generally where they don't lead the market by any means. Do you know the charging speeds, Toddy? Did they tell you that stuff?
Well, I know the fundamental is 25 watts wired charging is the max wired across all three models. It does.
Oh, really? Because the Ultra used to be faster. Right?
Yeah, as far as I'm aware, I've seen no mention of 45 watt charging. There was rumor of a 45 watt charger when we were doing rumors of the S21 series. And maybe there is a new 45 watt charger coming out, but that will only work with, you know, I think, was it the Note 20 series or the S20 series? The S20 Ultra supported 45 watts?
Yes. That sounds right to me.
Yeah, and then there's 10 watt wireless charging. And then there's the power share feature, the reverse wireless charging. I'm not sure what the speed is for that. We looked at, I mentioned during the end of the stream as well, that on Samsung's website, they offer a new wireless charger. Weirdly, that's 9 watts. I don't know why that's a watt lower than what the phones actually support. I don't know what the logic is there, but they have a new charger, which looks fine. It's a kind of square charger rather than a circular one. But yeah, so 25 watt charging, PD charging support, 10 watt wireless, reverse wireless, but no charger in box. And if you look at the accessories on Samsung's site, it just has the 25 watt travel adapter is the only one they sell.
Yeah. I mean, it makes sense not to up their speeds the same year they stop supplying a charger, because obviously they're banking on people upgrading from old devices and often old Samsung devices. So to kind of say, hey, this phone charges faster, but only if you buy the charger, because we're not giving you a charger, wouldn't really fly. It definitely feels like, I think we said this before, but Samsung's in a nice position to do this, because charging speeds are not their strong suit. They've never made them their strong suit. I guess from that, when that phone started exploding all the time, they've been very careful about fast charging.
Yeah.
And so it suits them pretty well to just not talk about it and just be like, yeah, it charges, it's fine, don't think about it.
Yeah, I do wonder, we still don't really know, like, it seems more positive this time around with regards to the difference between the Exynos and the Snapdragon in terms of power efficiency, based on, you know, the figures that Samsung was throwing out for the 2100 launch the other day. But whether or not, you know, that actually transpires, that the Exynos is more power efficient or still as, like, there's still an inequality, we'll know once the phones are actually in our hands.
They're astonishingly similar chips on paper. And I think we were under the impression that Samsung worked with Qualcomm on developing the chip. So it kind of makes sense that they've ended up, they both have the exact same architecture in terms of they've got the X1 Prime core, 3 performance cores, 4 efficiency cores. Samsung has tuned its clock speeds a little bit higher across all of those cores, which is probably how it's thus able to, if you look at, you know, the Geekbench scores we've seen so far, the Exynos is a little bit higher than the Snapdragon 888, and that's probably just that clock speed stuff. I suspect in actual day-to-day they're going to be as close as anything. So like you said, it's going to come down to power efficiency again. It's just, have they closed that gap, which is the one that always mattered for me. When you got 2 hours more battery life on a Snapdragon than you did on an Exynos, it was just not good enough. And we'll see. I was slightly surprised on the 8K video thing, because they were very, I was very impressed in the Exynos event the other day when they said it could do 8K at 60 frames per second. And it made me double check. And yeah, the Snapdragon does 8K at 30. Last year's S20s did 8K at 24. And I thought, oh, interesting. So we're definitely getting the upgrade to 8K at 30. And maybe they're going to do this differentiator where they say, I wasn't sure if they would or not, but I thought you might get this thing. Well, if you get the Exynos version in Europe, you get 8K at 60, and it kind of would change the narrative around Exynos v Snapdragon. But No, they don't even do the 8K at 30 that the Snapdragon can theoretically do.
We probably also don't want to kneecap the Snapdragon relationship as much.
I did wonder if there might be some contractual thing about different features that maybe they're just not allowed to do that or something.
Well, I always find it interesting that they kind of, especially with the today's Unpacked, they showed like footage of like free runners doing like parkour stunts and stuff, fast motion stuff, which 24 FPS, I guess you get a cinematic feel, but it's not actually going to be, you know, 8K is all about the crisp resolution, and 24 FPS means you're actually going to get some pretty blurry footage if that's what you're shooting with that 8K 24 FPS feature. So I think it's all about, if you're going to use this feature, buy the phone for this feature. You need to know what you're going to use it for. Otherwise, it is absolutely pointless. I mean, I can see value in it in very specific circumstances, but I think for the average user, it's still just a numbers thing, just to kind of throw on the marketing and be like, this is impressive. And it is. It is.
Yeah, the Exynos also delivers, because I think 8K is still pointless. The Exynos also does 4K at 120, which again, I was sort of wondering if we'd see, but there was nothing about that unless I missed it.
No, the only kind of hook with 4K is that all the sensors can now shoot in 4K, so you can move between the ultra wide and the main, and you know, you get the same resolution and frame rate across all of them, which is nice. I think that even includes the front camera if that didn't already do that.
Right, okay, yep. Yeah, I feel like we've run through in a way. I thought we might want to spend longer talking about the S21s, but I'm kind of like, I don't know what else there is to say. It's very similar to the S20s. There's not a lot feels like it's changed to me, which is interesting.
Which is probably why I was going back. And yeah, they through almost all of the S line's life, they've incremented the number by one. Last year, then it jumped from the S10 to the S20. Now they're back to just incrementing by one.
Yeah. Do you think they're going to stick with like mirroring the phone names in the years? Or do you think they're going to, they'll jump to the S31 next year or something? Or the S27?
Okay. I mean, S22.
Pull a number out of a hat. Yeah.
Seeing how confident they are and how much better it is than their previous phone.
S2100. They just add more zeros to the back.
Wow.
Actually, Toddy, I've got one question for you. I didn't quite notice myself during the presentation. Display curvature. Last year, they obviously all but entirely flattened out the displays.
Not enough.
Have they? Where are we at with that this year? I didn't really notice if they've recurved them. I know there were some rumors it was going to go back to a curve, and I assume not.
There was no mention of it in the pre-release. Obviously, yeah. I've still only seen them in like renders and images and product photos sent by Samsung to me, so I can't like get up close and study it just yet. But the rumors were that the S21 and I think the 21 Plus would have flat displays, but the Ultra would have a curved edges display. If it is curved on the S21 and S21 Plus, it's subtle. It might just be on the actual black of the bezel, which is thin, but there still.
I think that's how it was last year. They were technically, weren't fully flat. They had just a slight curve at the edge for comfort. But
yeah, I think the only thing really is the fact that the bezels now are more even around all four sides, but they are still ever so slightly curved, I think. That's something we can absolutely explore. We should have at least one of the devices pretty soon for review.
Yeah.
So yeah, we'll be able to answer that one hands-on wise pretty soon.
Maybe let's go back to that camera model design and see how it's sitting with us all. Yeah, I like it. I don't love it. I think I always say this with the camera model stuff. I often just like the fact that they're doing something a bit different.
Yeah.
And I respect the fact that they've changed up their camera module. It is absolutely an improvement on last year.
Yeah, the Domino was... Ugh.
Yeah, like they got it so wrong with the 20 series. So
it informed so many other manufacturers, though. A lot of other manufacturers then saw that style and just decided to kind of emulate it, which I thought was odd because it wasn't the winning design for me.
Yeah. I like this. I think a lot of the color combinations they're doing with it are terrible. I think that's really where they're losing.
The custom
red gold is no good
for me, but I know, Lewis, you like
that's
that.
That's what I want.
I like the red, but put that red with a black sensor, and the ones that have a carbon fiber sensor just make it a black sensor, and it's just things like that, like the lineups there, the way they've mashed up those colors together doesn't work.
Yeah, I mean, if I'm being picky, I'd love a nice, you know, the gold accent and just a nice royal blue. You know, I think that'll go quite nice.
Uh-huh. I could go with that. Works. Asus has done that a few times with their like fancy laptops, and I'm kind of here for it.
Got the right idea.
Considering they showed us that guy who is in charge of like picking the right black.
Yeah.
To then allow someone else to make the decision that you could pair the red with the gold.
Yeah. He must be
offensive
human.
To him, that yeah. guy who spends all his time picking the right shade of black and the right finish of frosted glass.
I feel bad for whoever was doing the silver, because they just threw that one out. Like, you know, we got a 5-minute segment about picking the perfect Phantom Black, but then Phantom Silver is just like, yes, yeah, it's in silver too.
I like the Ultra is not a pretty phone, but I like it in silver because I get that kind of 80s Japanese tech vibe. Like, it feels like a kind of Sony Walkman-ish or mm-hmm. some sort of old VHS player kind of vibe. And I'm here for that.
Totally. maybe this is a good excuse to start segueing into other stuff, because the thing I've been thinking all day when I'm looking at the S21 camera stuff is how much I prefer Samsung's own design for the A32 5G camera,
yes.
which they just kind of casually announced last night or this morning, depending on your time zone. But they just threw out a new budget device, the A32 5G, and it looks brilliant. It looks way better than the S21 phones.
It's nice. It's Ooh. Like super clean, very flat.
Yeah. So it's got some colored designs, and it's just flat back, and then the lenses sit on there, but there's no module around them. It's like the lenses sit just on the back. Well, and black, and kind of popping out.
I understand why they did it on the Ultra, because they probably needed room at the bottom for the folded for the optics. Periscope.
Yeah,
but yeah, having it kind of staggered like that looks really nice.
Yeah.
Also, I wonder what the difference is between the three main lenses in terms of like how much of a camera bump sticks out of the back. Mm. But either way, the whole module isn't sticking out. Yeah. Wow. I hadn't looked at these yet.
Mm, yeah, it really took me by surprise. I don't normally get excited about budget or mid-range Samsung phones. I think they don't do that well in those segments. But at least aesthetically, that one, I was just immediately like, oh, that's great. Understated, simple, but it really, really works. And you can see it's kind of skewing a little bit after the iPhones, but does a better job of what they're going for, it feels to me. Like, I don't know if that's fair.
Is it fair to assume that the contour cut, the new camera kind of aesthetic name, is going to feature on all of the kind of A series and the other kind of lower devices as we move through, or do you think they're going to follow what this A32 5G is doing instead? Where's your money at?
That's a good question, actually. I wonder if they'll keep this as a flagship feature. You know, keep it the S series. The S series has this cool contour cut. We'll see it in the S21 FE, I imagine, but I do wonder if... my leaning would be that we won't see this filter all the way down. We might see it in the foldables, though, maybe, to also sit at the top end of the range. You know, they might adopt the same kind of design. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm curious. Yeah, I mean, we're now in the funny state where it, depending on what their schedule is, it might be ages before we get anything else from Samsung. But I think the speculation is they're going to drip feed devices this year. And that's maybe another part of the shifting to January, as I know some of the talk has been that the next Z Flip is going to be March-ish or something like that. Yeah, it'll be like more sort of a phone every couple months.
Every quarter, there'll be an expensive device, and then the mid-ranges and the budget will just kind of pepper themselves out in between.
Mm.
You can buy something all year long.
Yeah, well, that's the idea, right?
I think they just don't want to have that twice a year. They want to be there all year.
Oh, we've got a question for you, Adam, in the comments.
Yes.
When will the camera comparison segment return? So.
Oh, great question. Yes. You know, the last one I did was right before the pandemic hit, at least the Bay Area. and so I got that one out very late. And then, yeah, I did not do one at the end of last year. I unfortunately don't have any plans for it, just because it's a little harder to do given the
situation.
Quite
outdoorsy, isn't it? You have to do a lot of location shooting.
Which, I mean, you know, it's safer than doing it inside. I think it's just more the logistics of it. I've got plenty of other stuff I need to worry about. As much as I really, really wish I could do a handful of camera comparisons every year, I just haven't. I haven't been able to prioritize it, so I'm bummed about it. But yeah, I want to return to it, and like I've said before, I really want to start focusing a little bit more on the mid-range too, because on the high end, I just started to split hairs and it just got really grating. I think that a lot of the play is happening in the mid-range, in the low end, honestly, because I think that's where people really are more or less informed about cameras as well. Yeah. So, yeah, but hopefully one day.
Fingers crossed. The people want it.
yes. Yeah, I want it too. Believe me.
I can say we probably will be throwing in more general phone comparison videos, I think, sort of roundups of our picks of the best mid-range and flagship and budget stuff on a rolling basis. So we're going to wait for this wave of stuff to come out. But there probably will be a video where we're picking out and, you know, pitting the top flagships up against each other. It just won't be camera specific like Adam's videos are. Cool. Yeah. So I guess other big launches from the last week or so, not really a launch, but let's start by talking about the LG Rollable, which we saw a like 3-second video of,
which did not look real.
I was gonna say it wasn't a render, but
yeah, something definitely. I was not sure how much of that was genuine, but we've seen what looks to be, you know, the LG Rollable in action, going from the full screen and then rolling down to compact size. LG have insisted it is coming out this year. So they may, I know we've seen the Oppo X concept, and TCL have also had a concept rollable that they've shown off before. LG are the only company so far, I think, actually they said on the record, we're releasing one and that it is releasing this year. So we are going to see that, have this one in our hands within the next 12 months.
I'm kind of here for just LG becoming like old school Nokia and being the ones to make the crazy phones. Like we saw with the, what was it? The Flip 5G, what was it called?
The LG Wing.
The wing.
Is that what you mean? Yeah.
Yes, the Wing, thank you. So I'm excited for it if it is coming this year. And as I mentioned earlier, the scrollable from Samsung is potentially coming this year too. And as you said, the Oppo phone. So yeah, it could be an interesting year for form factors, more so than most.
Yeah, I planned on doing an opinion piece about how I love that LG is just experimenting, throwing everything at the wall. I've always loved that about LG, is that they're willing to go out there and do some weird stuff, and they're really doubling down on it. Not that I would necessarily use any of the phones as a daily phone, but I'm glad that they're out there pushing the boundary.
Someone needs to be doing that stuff.
Yeah, I really wanted to see more of it in action. They, you know, like, it just seemed like such a little tease that they, I don't know, it didn't instill confidence in me. We're ready to show at least something more than just that quick little clip.
I guess the difference is because
I was gonna say that they did at least commit to their dual screen accessory with a bunch of phones.
Yeah, so they went hard on that.
Yeah, maybe they're kind of like feeling out what the next thing they commit to is with all of these kind of like concept-y concept phones you can buy.
I think the commitment there is exactly what I was going to say. It's, they're in a different space because Oppo's shown off a concept device, and when they showed off the Oppo X, there was no promise that this is what the final, you know, that, yes, Oppo will probably release a rollable phone, but there was no promise that it will look like the Oppo X did, the thing that they showed off. Whereas because LG has kind of said they are going to put the rollable out, whatever they show has to be what they put out, right? They and we're not expecting to see it. There were some rumors before that it would be Q1, like March, but I think the latest we've heard is probably more September as a likely time for it.
And I really hope they keep the name Rollable. I can imagine going into a phone store and be like, hey, can I buy that LG Rollable? It reminds me of like a fruit roll-up or something.
Do you think it's going to be like the LG Roll ThinQ 5G Plus? Like,
that's the fear though, isn't it? You
know, never mind. That's what's going to happen.
Do we think it's going to be a flagship? Because like the Wing had a 7.3, was it 7.65?
7.65. I think they're going to stay in that space of these 7.67 series chips. They kind of led the charge with that, with the Velvet, of saying, hey, look, we can put out something that's a flagship in many other respects, but uses a 7 series chip. You know, they were, I think, the first company to do that, really.
But the Velvet did have a little bit of hiccups in terms of performance. I think they'll be able to get past that, though.
I think they'll be... Oh, sorry, yeah.
I don't know what the deal is, but like part of the driving force behind such like vehement adoption of the 765 or 765G was that apparently the 865 was a particularly expensive flagship chip.
Yes.
And we don't know the unit cost for the 888. I imagine they might have looked at that just as Samsung's looked at the pricing of the S21 series to try and drive more people to buy their most, you know, powerful chip. So I could see the 888 coming back into play this year, but
part of that comes down to the 865 didn't have the integrated modem, which the 888 does. And I did say kind of something to this effect, I think, when they announced the 888 and didn't announce a 7 series with it, that felt telling that they maybe felt like the 765 had stolen the 865's thunder and they didn't want the 777 to do the same again this year or something. So, you know, we still haven't heard what the new top tier 7 series is.
Yeah.
That is a nice sweet spot, though, in terms of performance. There's better performance is getting better across the whole range. And I don't always feel like I need to have the top chip anymore. Totally. Yeah.
What became funny about the 765G is that you could find it in phones ranging from like £800 down to £200. Like LG put it in near flagship devices. Other people put it in mid ranges, and then some other people managed to squeeze it into budget phones by just pairing off some of the rest of the feature set. Mm-hmm. So it really became kind of whatever price you wanted, you could get that level of performance, which did kind of democratize that high tier Snapdragon feature set, which I think is a good thing.
Someone's made a good point, just jumping back to S21 stuff for a second, on Twitter, and it's been shared in our work Slack, but if you pair the red and gold S21 that we've been kind of berating, you can pair it with the AirPods Max in a blush color, and it's basically the same tones. So that's probably Lewis's ultimate pairing, as he is kind of the resident Apple guy.
Right, so let's move on from LG. I'm going to kind of take this in a slightly haphazard order, probably. Let's stick with phones for the moment. The Oppo Find X3, which hasn't been announced. but given we've been talking about camera modules a lot, we might as well
The theoretical
Oppo Find X3, Evan Blass, EvLeaks, has leaked what look to be and what he claims are official internal renders of the Find X3 Pro. And they certainly look like they are the real deal.
There is something you can sometimes tell when something is like a fan-made render versus like a press shot. And these look like press shots. And they kind of fall into the same design and layout and formatting that we've seen from previous Oppo products. So I'm inclined to believe them.
If they're fake, they're incredibly well done fakes.
Yes.
Yes.
It is hideous. So for anyone listening who can't see it or who hasn't seen it yet, it's got just a quad camera array, which is kind of fine, but instead of having like a module that juts out from the back of the phone slopes up around the module to meet the lenses, kind of like a very wide volcano, you know, it's just slowly sloping up from the side.
It's a mesa.
To a summit.
Yes,
it is. Yeah, it's a mesa, thank you. I can see how they got to it, but I also think that they should have gotten to it in a concept stage. Scrunched that piece of paper up, thrown it in the bin.
We're kind of like the guy who's choosing the next blacks in Samsung.
Yeah, they needed
like,
to throw those blacks
off the wall. We don't need
those. Oppo wasn't willing to make the tough decisions, realized they'd made the wrong shade of black and move on.
But it's interesting as well that they've gone for the offset camera setup, and it kind of blended to that, because that is decidedly, you know, that offset that we were saying like Samsung could have done with the S20 21 Ultra, but didn't. It's first and foremost, it looks like kind of like the iPhone camera setup, the Pro models at least.
Mm-hmm.
That can't be coincidence, I don't think.
No, it's surely with that in mind. What's also weird on the camera selection and the way they designed the module is, from what we understand, the rumor is it doesn't have a periscope, a folded one. So they don't need the module to jut out as much. And you'd think maybe then they would have taken advantage of that to work on not drawing attention to a big ugly camera module.
Yeah, well, Yeah, because there's two reasons. You either are trying to hide just how far out it's coming, right? Mm-hmm. To just be like, oh, it doesn't come out that far. It's a visual effect. Or, I mean, maybe they're able to cram other stuff in there that they were like, hey, we got the rest of the phone thinner, so yep. we put some things in that bump. I don't know. There's got to be a reason for it. There's definitely got to be a reason for it. It doesn't bug me, I think, as much as it bugs you. But I'm also thinking, how is it going to work with cases?
Yeah,
like, because you're going to start to, like, they're going to have to mold that plastic around, and it's going to be thinner on those edges by the camera module. Maybe it's not going to be a problem. Form, it looks like there's still a little bit of a bump once you get to the top of the slope, and then it bumps up and plateaus. So maybe, I don't know.
Also, I'm not loving these finishes. The black one is nice, the shiny black, and then there's the rest are kind of like a satin finish, and there's a sort of like pale denim blue, and there's a kind of pearl white, and then there's this gold, but it looks kind of like, I don't know, what, oatmeal?
It's the vegan orange again. I don't know if it's the exact same as last year's one, but that one is a leather finish again, I think. The orangey one.
Really? Yeah.
I think that's the expectation.
I'm not sold on these, like, there you go. The vegan orange and gold is a powerful, notable combination. I don't know if it's the one I would pick.
Yeah, it's definitely, looking at that again, it's definitely a different shade of orange to the Find X2 Pro. It looks more yellowy, more goldy, less orangey, but
yeah.
Still, I don't understand. We've just seen the same thing with the ZTE Axon 20. I'm finishing up my review of that, and you know, you've got black glass back or yellow leather. And I get extremes. Why we're getting all these vegan leather finishes, but I don't know why everyone is making them yellow. Of all the colors, I'm very confused.
It's vegan.
Yeah.
Well, what was it? The LG G4 that had like the brown footballish kind of leather.
Yeah. Yeah, with the stitches down the middle.
Yeah, yeah.
That was a weird one.
That was the in thing for a while, wasn't it?
Mm. It was.
Oh, do you remember the Galaxy Note 3, I think, it was on a plastic back, but with a fake stitch in the molding of the plastic, and then a leather kind of texture.
Yep.
Oof, wow, we've come a long way. I would say this is all better than it was, at least.
Honestly, though, it's definitely a big departure from the original Find X, which actually I really did like that finish on the back, the color gradient, the way it shimmered. That original Find X I was a fan of.
So good.
The look of it.
Yeah, very clean.
Yeah. So, I mean, everything else we know about the Find X3, again, it was sort of funny when I wrote our article sort of rounding up everything, and every single section was like, well, we know this thanks to Evan Blass, and thanks to Evan Blass, and you know, props to Evan Blass for leaking this. Yep. Everything we know about the Find X3 has come from Evan Blass, so across several leaks. So I don't know who he's got in inside Oppo, but man, they are fully under his thumb.
Anything huge?
It's nothing wild. The Snapdragon 888, as you would expect. March launch is the plan. That matches what they did last year. So again, that's what you would expect. One minor change, they're probably going to do all four models at once. Last year, we had the Find X2 and the Find X2 Pro, and then a Neo and a Lite followed later in the year. Apparently, all of them are coming at once. But this will slightly tidy up your bugbear about the Reno line, Toddy, because... Or maybe it'll make it worse. I don't know how you're going to take this. apparently, the Find X2 Lite is the Reno 5. The Find X3 Lite is the Reno 5.
And then
so the Reno 5, basically, it's going to become a region lock thing now to an extent. So the Reno won't release in every market.
I think that's
markets
good.
That don't get the Renos get them those phones, but under bits of the Find X banner.
I mean, that's, I think, a clearer marketing line to take.
Yeah,
because the Reno is like trolled so much of the Find X line last year. It was so just for their consumer. Like, at least you know I'm spending time trying to unpick all this and understand it to convey to people.
It's your
but
job
for consumers, consumer just sees a poster. They're not going to know without like literally a side by side spec sheet, and then probably still question which is better because the names are different.
So I think basically the line now is the Renos aren't going to come to the West. It'll just be Find X, and then. Other their sort of A-series budget stuff the rest of the year. Obviously in China and in some other markets you'll still get both series, and but they, you know, Oppo's a bigger brand there, and maybe they're more established and people are more familiar with the lineup. Otherwise, nothing too crazy. The funny thing is what we knew from a while ago, the one thing we know directly from Oppo is that it will have a 10-bit display and 10-bit color running through the whole process, and they kind of threw themselves under the bus and said, you know, oh, the Find X2 Pro was 10-bit, but it wasn't really 10-bit. Now we're really giving you 10-bit.
Well, yeah, there is a fake 8 plus 2, which equals 10, but it's not true 10-bit.
But I like they didn't really, like, they obviously knew the whole time, but they just, you know, they did drop themselves in it, but they left it until a year on from launching the phone to tell people that. Thanks for the money, I guess.
Well, I think if somebody dug hard enough, I'm sure they probably would have been able to get pushed into a corner on it. But, you know, technically, 8 plus 2 is 10.
So, yeah, there's going to be 10-bit color in terms of display. They're also touting that everything, like the cameras, will capture in 10-bit, and every step of the process, encoding, storage, all of it will remain 10-bit. So there's no point where any of it is lost, basically.
Which is pretty cool, yeah.
Which is cool. So if you care about that stuff, they claim to be the people doing the best job of that.
Is the benefit for that when you go to, like, sharing them on, like, social platforms where they're going to get compressed, like, they'll get compressed in such a way that less detail is lost or less color depth is lost or something? Is that the benefit of having a higher bit rate?
No, because the throughput, you know, even if they can capture and store and edit it in 10-bit, you're still going to be converting it down. I would say the benefit is being able to edit ahead of time. But once again, not editing in the app, but or like something like Instagram, some editing in a native app,
whatever is
on their phone, or probably maybe they have Lightroom support too. I don't know.
I mean, it's similar to like having raw support from, you know, the iPhone and the S21 series as well now.
Exactly. Yeah.
And actually, we probably should have spoken about this when we're mocking the design of the camera module. But the camera setup is quite different. I spoke about this fact that they're apparently not doing a periscope, but the rest of it's all kind of just a bit interesting. So they're going to be one of the first to use a new Sony sensor, the IMX766. So they're going to have that 50-megapixel. Sony sensor is the main camera, and a second 50 megapixel for the ultra wide, which matches what they did last year in that they had 48 and 48 for both the main and the ultra wide. So kind of pushing the idea that your ultra wide is just as good as your main lens. They're then going to have a 2x optical zoom telephoto, and then a macro camera as the fourth. And no,
they get these macros on these high end phones.
It's an odd one.
When it's okay, when there's a lot of light and the right conditions, I actually like using a macro mode. But yeah, I think more to your point, the biggest problem I've always had is that, when you switch over to a wide angle and it's a different sensor, they didn't treat it with the same kind of lens treatment, it becomes a completely different image. And you're just like, whoa, this is not what I saw if I'm kind of switching between the two. So hopefully that helps mitigate a lot of the differences there.
I think Oppo's actually been pretty good, even when they're using different sensors of different kind of qualities, not just resolutions, but just like quality of sensor. They seem to pay particular attention to trying to make sure that the color science is consistent enough.
iPhone's
hats off to them
too.
For that.
Yeah.
And we're going to see more and more of this, because one of the big things with the 888, which I guess Samsung were talking about a little bit in there, is that way that you can seamlessly switch between lenses now, because the sensors the processors can handle every camera sensor at once. So, you know, Samsung had it where they're showing you the feed of each camera all the time, and you can pick which one to dive through. But, you know, part of the pitch of the 888 and the next tier of processors is that switching between camera lenses is going to be much more seamless, much easier.
Cat.
It's a cat.
If you're not watching the video version, you're missing out.
That was Cheddar has an internal clock that from 5 o'clock onwards, even though his dinner's at 6, it's dinner time.
Yeah.
And this is how
the dinner
know.
Window has opened.
Yeah, exactly. My cat, it's like a 2-hour window. So
mine just all day bugging me until I give him food. And I'm like, no.
Yeah.
There we go. Crap! No, I the cat totally forgot what I was.
Sorry, it's a Cheddar.
I'm sorry.
Are we excited for the Find X3 as a phone, or X3's Pro? Like, do we think it's going to be one to watch, like the X2 Pro was, or is the design going to undermine everything that it brings to the table?
Yeah, the design has put me off. I didn't love the look of the first one. That was my least favorite thing about the Find X2 Pro. I had the orange leather edition, and I never liked it. But the rest of the phone was phenomenal. It was just a bit overpriced.
Yeah.
So, I got a question, because I've the PR person that I work with, I've put in requests, but the last Oppo phone that I've used is a Find X, the mm-hmm. original Find X. Have they changed the software experience?
Yes.
Okay.
Color OS is a lot better now.
Okay.
That's what always
killed it for me was the software experience.
It's not my favorite, but it's a lot better than it was. And I know some people for whom it is their favorite. I know a few tech reviewers who prefer color to Oxygen, or to stock. So it's a lot better. For me, it's still a little bit too, I don't like the design language that much. I think is the main thing, but in usability, it's, you know, worlds ahead of what it used to be.
Okay, yeah. That's good.
Agreed.
That's good.
I do wonder if there was some Oppo OnePlus partnership there, if Oppo dragged some people back over from OnePlus to help fix their software side, but who knows? Yeah, so I think I'm excited. I think I don't like how it looks, but I didn't like how it looked last year. If the biggest change is that they've dropped the Periscope, which we all said earlier we never use, then that's fine by me. And if they focused on making the main and the ultra wide better, then
with the bump size it is, though, I kind of would at least have hoped for a 3x sensor, like we've seen, like the Huawei P30, for example, was one of the first phones I remember that had a flat 3x. It didn't use Periscope, mm-hmm. and that just feels more meaningful than having a 2x zoom.
Yeah, 2x seems a bit low for what it is, but it's also hard to say because obviously all of this is leaked, none of it's confirmed, and there's going to be a Find X3 and a Find X3 Pro, and so it's always possible with this stuff that the leaks get jumbled up a bit, and what we may be hearing are the specs for one of them that are different in the other one. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's too early to say absolutely for sure what's going to be in what phone, though Evan Blass said the renders were for the Pro model, but I assume the look will be very similar between the two. And then the light in the Neo will be different. Because like I said, the light is a Reno 5. I assume the Neo will be a Reno 5 Pro or something like that. Again, just repackaging something else. Yeah, I think that's all the phones we've had. The iQ 7 launched in China this week, which is the world's second Snapdragon 888 phone. That just beat Samsung to the punch, though. There's not a huge amount to say about it, except that it has 125-watt charging, which remains just absolutely silly, and I love it. I do worry about battery longevity, but it is very cool that they're getting that absurdly fast. That's five times the speed the Samsung charges at.
Is iQ BBK or is it someone else?
Was Vivo.
Yeah. It's a Vivo brand. So
Vivo is kind of BBK, but they don't like you to talk about it.
No, of course, none of them do.
But yeah, iQ was Vivo's gaming brand, and now it's become a bit less gaming focused, but it is still the kind of a little bit more enthusiast, I guess. Spec heavy would be how I'd sort of describe the iQ stuff. Spec heavy, but still kind of affordable. They managed to just beat Samsung to it, but there's not too much else to say. And we know for a fact it's not coming to the West, so that's just a Chinese only launch. Next week we're gonna have the Honor V40, so there are more phones coming soon. Other CES stuff, I mean, Adam, you'll probably have a better perspective than us to some extent, but a lot of the other CES stuff was very like PC heavy this year. You know, I think a lot of the biggest announcements were like laptop CPUs and GPUs from NVIDIA and AMD. And
yeah, I think there goes Toddy
fighting my cat here, sorry.
Now we got to see what laptop you're using. Spoilers. I mean, laptop, the CES is definitely, laptops are the name of the game. Desktops, there was a little bit here and there, but most of it's not going to come to fruition until later. The laptop game is definitely stepping up on both Intel, AMD, well, and NVIDIA as well. So yeah, that's where I focused a lot of my efforts over on the PC world side. Oh man,
distracting. Oh, so ever.
Yeah. we did actually back on the phone side have the little announcement right at the end of Samsung's Exynos event, where they confirmed that their next flagship SoC will have an AMD GPU.
Which is interesting.
We knew there was a partnership between them, but this was that they confirmed this time that the next chip, not clear if that means the one that launches in 12 months from now. Some leaksters have said it's coming this year, so there may be something in 6-7 months. But yeah, there's going to be the next Exynos, next flagship Exynos will have an AMD GPU. And so it's kind of interesting, because if Exynos has been lagging behind for a couple years, and then if we think maybe on paper this is the year Exynos has drawn level with Snapdragon, it's no surprise that they announced that in a way of saying, now we've caught up to them, next year we're getting ahead, at least on GPU.
Yeah, wow. Okay, I did not know that. That's interesting. I'll have to look into that.
I mean, there was a small CES phone announcement as well from TCL.
Yes, the mention. 20, TCL 20 stuff.
Yeah, which is, it's an odd one because they technically launched at least one, if not both, of the phones that are kind of ready to go on sale at the end of this month, the TCL 20 5G and TCL 20 SE at in Italy exclusively at the end of 2020 with like some carrier partners. So it's very odd that they kind of like, I guess it was like a test to see how they would do, but they are formally coming, like a global launch or international launch at the very least, due at the end of this month. And they were two of five phones that they've got kind of waiting in the wings as part of the new 20 series to come out.
The TCL 10s, I reviewed one of the 10s. It was fine, a very boring phone.
Yeah, they're not particularly exciting.
Fine for what it is, pretty decent specs for the price, perfectly competitive. Just, I don't know, I really struggled to get excited. And I looked at the 20s, hoping for more excitement, and had the same response of just kind of very middle of the road was my feeling.
Yeah, the 20 5G is going to be their most affordable 5G phone yet, so that's kind of like its claim. And it's rather than a 765G, which is kind of like gives you an idea of the level of performance that the last one did, this is a 690 5G, so it's a little less powerful as well. It's odd considering it's like sort of a successor name-wise. Meanwhile, the a TCL 20 SE is their cheapest phone.
Yeah.
I think it's going to be like 190 euros. And it's basically just a really big phone with like good stereo speakers and a HDR display for cheap.
Right.
So kind of display is their kind of focus on all their devices and affordability. So it's, nothing is groundbreaking here, but just figured I'd mention that there were some phones at CES from TCL.
Totally. And then you talking about the affordable 5G reminded me of three other phones that have launched this week that we haven't even mentioned yet. Which is Vivo launched a new Y series, China only for now, but actually this one probably will come out in the West, in the UK at least, in Europe. This is the first phone to have the Snapdragon 480, which is the first 4-series Snapdragon chip with 5G. So this should be a very affordable 5G phone from Vivo, and we'll probably see more budget 5G phones using that chip. But also then Xiaomi have the Redmi 9T and Redmi Note 9T. The Note 9T is a 5G phone that starts from 229 euros, but the early bird price is 199 euros, which I think makes it the cheapest 5G phone in Europe right now, but I'm not 100% on that, especially once you factor in phones from a year ago that have dropped in price. But we've had a deluge of phones over the last week, and there's just too much to keep up with. No word on when the Redmis are actually coming out, so we might be able to talk about them in more depth in a couple of weeks when we actually have one or something like that. I know some people have already got them, so if you look around YouTube, there are some hands-on videos with some of the Redmi ones at least. And Vivo, they've already released some Y series stuff, so I think that cheap Y series will probably come out to the UK as well.
With 5G being as kind of like democratized now as it is with so many of these affordable 5G phones coming in, like all the more reason why Samsung can drop 5G from its marketing, I think.
Yes, please. please.
Until they start calling it true 5G or something, they're going to start to signify between the different versions of 5G.
I've heard about like AT&T, Verizon, and their marketing around 5G is like really sketchy.
This one's 5G. This one's 5G plus. This one's 5G plus ultra.
Wideband 5G. Yeah.
Wasn't EE brought like doing 4G plus plus at one point?
I'm 4G plus plus. Maybe.
Yeah, in London only specifically. Like yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
It's all a mess.
I don't know.
Probably naming.
But yeah, no, I eagerly await the point where we don't have 5G in product names, because as you said, now you can buy, you know, a £200 phone, give or take, with 5G in. So it is everywhere. You know, it's going to be the case that you just don't even get a 4G phone. I think in 2022, no 4G phones will release in the UK at least.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I have already had one press release about 6G though, so...
Yes.
Hold on to your hats.
Well, once again, we need that guy who handles blacks over at Black Colors over at Samsung.
Just
pull these 5Gs off the shelf. And be like, you know what?
No, this marketing done is wrong. This marketing is wrong. Yes.
Yep. I think the other notable launch this week that is sort of fast charge adjacent is probably the OnePlus Band. It's not a phone, but a wearable that is India only.
Yep.
Is that right?
Yeah. For now. Yeah, it's an odd one, I guess, because everyone was expecting OnePlus to launch a smartwatch.
And said they're doing a watch.
They're
making a watch.
And they'd already said, and there's been like sketches from like years ago where they had the concept in the wings. And so everyone was assuming this big wearable launch that was kind of rumored to be, you know, kicking off real soon. I think it was on the Monday, right? The 11th of Jan. Initially, it was expected to be the watch, and then like a day or so before, like shots of this fitness tracker started popping up, and there is now, you know, it looks very similar to other slim fitness trackers like the Fitbit Inspire 2 and the Honor Band 5 and 6 and the Xiaomi Mi Band 5. Like, it's just one of those kind of thin vertical trackers with a color OLED display. The tracker pops out of the band. You can change the band colors. It is swim proof, which is nice. It doesn't have GPS, but it's really cheap. I think with an early bird price again of 249 rupees, which translates to like £25, $30, somewhere around there. So it's super affordable. I think it's great for, you know, India as a market. I think they're going to love it. They love the OnePlus brand as a whole. So having just more ways to support the brand for those consumers is a smart idea, and especially when it's so affordable as this. Of course, it has cricket as one of the 13 modes of sport in track, because
really, wow,
yeah of course
that is targeted. Okay.
Cricket and yoga, which I think is pretty important for the Indian market, absolutely. So
also,
I think
the UK too then.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, when we
just have like a Commonwealth release of this cricket tracker.
Yeah, there's been no mention of an international release at all yet, but I can't, there's nothing specific about the way it's been designed, the software, the user experience, even the marketing, that suggests that it is only going to stay in India. There just hasn't been anything to suggest the contrary. So if it does come out, hopefully it'll be soon and we don't have to wait too long for it.
Do we know, is there anything that you only get like if you're specifically using a OnePlus phone that doesn't work on other phones?
I think there is some interplay with the, I don't know whether it was unique to the OnePlus 8T or whether it was just part of the latest build of Oxygen OS, but there's the new lock screen with the kind of activity monitor that goes down the screen as the day. Yeah, I think they've got something that syncs up with that on the band, so it kind of matches, which is kind of nice. But they have this new OnePlus Health app, which is what it's syncing with, which I think works on any Android device from Android 6 and up. And it's coming to iOS soon, but isn't yet on any iPhone stuff. So, yeah, I don't think there's any OnePlus specific features. There might be a few kind of notification things, maybe, but I don't know, there's camera control. But again, without having one, I can't test how specific that is to Android, OnePlus, or just generally the experience that this band offers.
Because they're still bad at that with their headphones, which is still very much positioned by them as full OnePlus phone owners. I'm not sure if they fixed this since the last pair I reviewed, but when I reviewed the last Buds, the last flagship Buds, not the Buds Z, you could only access the controls on a OnePlus phone because it was built into the OS. There was no app for it. So if you wanted to change the shortcuts, like what tapping on a Bud did, you couldn't do that without a OnePlus phone. There was no way to change that, which I found especially frustrating because by default, tap was skip track or something. And none of the controls were to pause. You had to take them out of your head, out of your ear to pause. And if you don't have a OnePlus phone, you literally couldn't change that. And it was just like, yeah, you're stuck with the worst default control scheme.
That's
nothing you can do about it. Very, very odd. But I'm hoping they're learning from that. I'm curious if this does come out wider because the OnePlus TV is still India only. And we've seen with the Nord, they've started more and more fragmenting their global release plans and different devices in different markets and hitting, you know, we only, the regular Nords doesn't come to the US, the N10 and the N100 do tomorrow, having been out everywhere else in November. So they're clearly not treating every market the same way anymore. So I wonder if this... Not. And I do wonder with a lot of the, you know, criticism they've had about building the brand out, I wonder if they're going to, if they're more careful about that outside of India, maybe, or they see it will play differently outside of India, I don't know. And if they feel like this wouldn't work, you know, they want to keep being primarily phones in Europe or something.
Especially in the affordable space, it's a pretty saturated market right now. So I don't know whether I would expect to see them move into other markets.
I think that's it, isn't it? They've got such a strong brand presence in India, from my understanding, in a way that they have a strong fan brand in the West.
Yeah.
But when the cheap wearable market, obviously Fitbit dominates the wearable market in terms of the household name, and then you've got Xiaomi and Honor nailing it on the sort of ones you can buy for 30 quid.
Yeah.
And I just don't know who buys the OnePlus one except OnePlus loyalists.
Yeah, absolutely.
But yeah, we'll see. I'm sure there's loads of CES stuff we haven't mentioned, so jump in the comments and let us know if there is and if there's something you want us to talk about next week. But we are going to have to wrap it up because we have been talking for 2.5 hours by my count. and I'm ready to not talk for a while. Yeah. But thank you for everyone who's been watching and listening. And thank you to all of you guys for jumping in. I guess let's end with a very quick S21, yay or nay? I'll go first. I'm nay.
Nay for the whole thing.
Just, they're fine. They just, but just from a year on, it looks like the same, maybe a bit worse, but cheaper. It doesn't do enough for me.
Yeah, I think I'm the same. I'd go nay. Bit boring.
I guess, the Galaxy S range is typically the default option if you're not getting an iPhone. I think in that regard, they've done enough. Okay. I just don't, they're not exciting, and I don't think I would buy one if I was like looking at all the flagships in that sort of price range on the shelf. But yeah, I think they've done enough, but that's only going to work for so long.
Yeah.
I'm going to give it a yay because they nailed the blacks.
They really did nail those. Yeah,
that one guy, Black, he should get a raise. Chef's kiss.
Yeah,
he did start interviewing that guy.
All right, well, that is us for this week. We will be back at 4 p.m. as usual next week. That's 4 p.m. GMT. I know we will be talking about the Honor V40 series because that launches on January 18th. I do not know what else, but we will see when we get there. All right.
But by then, my cat will be fed.